All right, thank you all for coming. My name is Jason Grigsby. I'm one of the people who helped organize Mobile Portland. I am extremely excited this month because we have a pretty unique opportunity. We have people coming in from Seattle and San Francisco and also Portland to come talk about mobile analytics, which is something that I am personally very interested in and want to understand better, because I don't think a lot of businesses yet are thinking about how analytics differs from web to mobile. I see a lot of people basically assuming that the analytics that they're using will help them and will be sufficient for doing mobile, and that's not necessarily the case. I also am really excited because this is the first month we've done this afternoon session. So this is a bit of an experiment, and we're going to see how it goes. We wanted to set up sort of a more intimate gathering for people to get an opportunity to learn about mobile analytics. And then this evening, we're going to continue the topic, but at sort of a higher level, talking about big picture where mobile analytics is going, as opposed to sort of the specifics of how particular platforms work. The first presenter, Isabel, is going to be talking about Flurry. It's her first time in Portland. So she's getting a wonderful, this is what the weather's always like. And Flurry, for those who don't know, is the premier native apps analytics platform. Like, that is my impression of it. I don't know whether that's categorically true. And none of the other speakers are here yet to contradict that. So I'm sure that they will have a different opinion. But people talk about Flurry all the time. As a matter of fact, Steve Jobs got an opportunity to call them out on stage. So, for some things that Flurry is partially responsible for changes in the terms of service for iOS. So Isabel can defend their actions in that regard as well. Sorry, I'm sorry. But I just want to welcome Isabel. Thank you for coming, and looking forward to it.
Teach me if anyone is still developing teaching me. So we reach about 300 million devices. That's about 98% of the smartphone market. And we track about 15 billion sessions. We have tracked about 15 billion sessions per month. And I've been told that's 3 times what Twitter tracks. So apparently that's a lot. The important thing to say, a lot of people ask, wait, the analytics are free, how do you make money? A lot of people want to know how to make money, which is a legitimate question. So on top of the analytics, we have an advertising network that we call App Circle that leverages all the data that we collect through analytics to make better advertising recommendations. But I'm not really going to talk about that because mostly today we're going to talk about analytics. So what I'm going to do first is kind of explain everything that is in the analytics tool. This thing is getting louder and louder. So I'm going to explain everything that's in the analytics tool, and then I'm going to try and focus on 2 or 3 features that are really useful for you, I think, as mobile app developers. But please, if you have questions, like ask me, you know, you can interrupt me. It's fine, apparently we have more time than expected, so we don't have to wait until the end. So the first thing that you can find in our analytics tools are usage statistics that are, you know, pretty important, and to kind of understand who's coming to your app. So you have all your new users, your active users. So this is for all of you that are kind of in the gaming space. Is probably the most important metric that we use to identify usage, daily average users. So it's important to know that. Sessions is also very important, because what we've noticed in the gaming space, it's not the companies that have the most DAUs that are the most successful. It's also the companies that have, you know, a core of, you know, really engaged players that come back several times a day. And this also, you know, is pretty apparent when you have certain companies, for example, where people come back in the app, you know, 4 or 5 times a day. You know, to manage their crops, to you know, grow whatever they're growing. Another important tool that you can use is the session length. That's also you know, pretty important, knowing how much time people spend in your app. Obviously, this differs a lot depending on the type of game or app that you have. Some people will play, you know, like for example, whole game of Words with Friends. Other people will put the app in the background and then just, you know, listen to music all day long. So it's kind of up to you to, and you're the game that you're tracking to figure out what the data is telling you. Another important thing is
thank you.
If we know that the game sometimes in the foreground and sometimes in the background in the session,
yes.
Can we pass that information?
Yes, you can. I don't actually have the exact data right now, but I know that since we've changed the way we track sessions since iOS 4 has evolved, so I think when an app has been inactive for 10 seconds, 15 seconds in the background, we stop counting as a session and it becomes a new session. But if you have information also that you track, you can also report it to the tool. Then finally, this is, user retention. This is a really important metric, especially when you're thinking of gaming. The way we define user retention is how many of the people that were, you know, if today is February 15th, is how many of the people that were playing on January 15th are playing today. So it's basically how much of your user base are you losing month for month. And that really is one of, I think as the mobile app world is evolving, you have companies, for example, you know, like, you know, Zynga, new toy, that have a penetration rate that is very, very important, meaning that, you know, everyone has probably seen or downloaded Words with Friends, something like that. And for these companies, what's important is not really, you know, how many new users they have, but how many of the users that they have, they manage to keep engaged and keep coming back every month. And so that's an important metric. This is also a cool little feature, and I think it kind of showcases that the Flurry SDK was really built by developers for developers. So you'll find a lot of actually technical features that are pretty nice. This one is a feature that allows you to see how many of your your users have converted to the latest application version that you have. So for example, if you're releasing a new version every month, you can see how fastly how fast every version has been adopted. And you can also see at a precise date, so you see, for example, at the right of the chart, how many of your people are still, you know, on an older version. And so that's yes.
So this sort of relates directly to the publishing of new updates to your iPhone app, for example, your iPad app.
Yes.
You can see the V1, V2, so on and so forth.
Yes.
And you can look at duration and latency. So it's released at 10 a.m. and it's at 4 hours.
So that's right now we can't tell you in terms of hours, we can tell you in terms of days. That's actually kind of one of the weaknesses of our SDK that we're trying to work towards, and I think that's important to start tracking on an hourly basis. So we're moving towards that. Right now you can only do that by day, but I mean we're working towards the hourly. I think the hourly is important too, especially for other types of metrics. Not yet. No, yeah, you can't. That's something that's kind of important in the other part of our business, on the advertising side. We want to try and target different people, you know, do campaigns that are going to be only, you know, in the morning, in the evening, as people do, for example, campaigns now that are only during the weekend. We want to do that also during the day. And I mean, I think this is something that we've heard a lot with our developers. I don't know if some of you have witnessed this already, but apparently numbers of DAUs and engagement increases with the release of new updates. So basically when developers release new updates, they see their users go back up and they see they kind of see re-engagement in their apps, which is nice. And probably also this, yeah.
Do you have the new versus returning users or new subscribers?
Can you tell in the
install? Like, so if you look at, we're releasing an app, day one, version 5, our adoption rate of net new users was higher than the previous time frame.
Yes, you can look at that by doing cycles.
Okay.
Basically, all the information here you can look at on a daily active user, monthly active user, or lifetime user, so you would be able to identify if it's just people coming back to your app or if it's new users. And then you could also, I'll go into that a little bit later, create segments. So often people kind of ask me, what are the benefits of implementing Flurry versus other competitors? The first thing I tell them is that it's free. Usually it's a pretty compelling argument. The second nice thing about Flurry is that given the kind of large dimension of our publishers, we track more than 100,000 apps. You can compare and benchmark your app, how your app is performing against the category that you're in. So that's pretty nice. So for example, here, if you look at session length, the first green little indicator is your app, and then the blue one is the benchmark of the games category. So for games, it's interesting, just because you can see, for example, if your users are staying more or less, the smaller the category, the more interesting it becomes, because obviously the pool is a little bit more, it's a little tighter. So for example, if you're in the travel category, if you're in the music category, it's nice to see how you're performing versus other games or apps in that category. You can also benchmark the frequency of use, how many times people are coming to your app, also the retention. So that's something that's always interesting to see how you're doing versus other people in your category. So this is something that's also really interesting and that you really want to set up if you implement the Flurry SDK. So the Flurry SDK actually is a complete packaged SDK that the implementation. It's really simple. It takes, apparently it takes something like 30 minutes to implement. And then if you want to go just a little bit deeper, and you should start tracking custom events. This is also really simple to do, apparently. I'm not a developer, but apparently it's pretty easy to do. And then what you want to start doing here is, the events that are in your app, that are, important to you, start tracking them so that you can see see how many users do these events that are important. So for example, the classic events are, you know, in-app purchasing, you know, reach level 5, then you can also apply that to, you know, for example, click on an ad banner if you want to see how many people are engaging with the advertising in your app, or whatever, share the link on Facebook, share the link on Twitter, all these kind of useful information. What you can do then is add parameters for detail. So the example that I use sometimes is like, if for example you add an event that say add an email address, for example, then within Flurry you can create up to 100 parameters and basically, for example, add a parameter called Hotmail, a parameter called Gmail, a parameter called, and then the app will automatically basically put every every solution into the parameter. And it will create a little user path that I can show you later. And see, you see, for example, out of all the people that entered, for example, an email address, you see it broken down by parameter. Then another thing that's interesting with the Flurry SDK is the audience segmentation. That's also something that is kind of very basic, that's not really provided by Apple in any way. Usually people have a kind of good sense of what their base looks like, just because through the in-app purchases they make or through Facebook Connect, for example, a lot of people have been using Facebook Connect as a way to identify the audience. In the new release that we released last week, that's called Analytics 3.0, we updated the audience segmentation, and we're now able to give you a demographic estimate of age and gender for your app. The way we do that, yes, sorry.
No, you started it. I was going to ask how you do it. I just wasn't patient enough.
This is the question that we get a lot. The way we do it is that we track about 98% of the apps on the market right now on smartphones. And so there's a really high chance that your user that's in your game has on his iPhone or his Android an app that has a Flurry SDK where he's reporting age or gender. So for example, if you look at all the social apps that use our analytics, most people, all the dating, the social, even the games where you have to, where you can be prompted to input that information. If your user has, given that information in another app that has the Flurry SDK in it, we use that information to, in your app. And then, so that's, you can see it here, for example. Now actually you can't see it here, sorry. So the way it's gonna appear is that on the right side here, just above the percentage, it's gonna tell you 23% of people is reported age, meaning we're using the information that they gave away in another app, and then it'll tell you the rest is our Flurry algorithm. So basically, we extrapolate the age and the gender using our algorithm that apparently is very I don't have any more information about it than that. But it works really well, apparently.
Sure. I'm going to miss this, but are you using the device ID to track?
Yes.
So do you have a plan for what to do when that gets deprecated in iOS 5?
Yes. I think that's going to be like a big question for everyone. So maybe at the end, we can like do a little chapter about the ID and what's going to happen. Are we going to die? When I agreed to come speak here, the articles haven't popped up yet, and then Peter, who's one of our organizers, with Jason, that I would come up here, was like, oh, by the way, everyone's probably going to have to do it. Try to make something up and say something coherent. And I'm like, okay, thank you. So I suggest we talk about it a little bit. So Analytics 3.0, we've been beta testing it for about a month with our developers, and then it's been officially released last week, and we've actually started doing, comparing the data that we get through the algorithm, comparing it to what our developers, when they have that information available, and they tell us that it's very coherent. Sometimes the story SDK, the estimates will tell you that they can extrapolate, and that, for example, is often pretty true with apps that are, for example, on iPad and on audiences that are older, 55 and plus. And the reason for that is just, it's not an audience that really signs up for social networking and stuff like that, so it's really hard to get an idea of who these people are. So sometimes we'll actually, it's a very, very, it's like, for example, 1% of apps, we won't be able to give you an estimate, but mostly for any kind of apps, we will be able to. We'll also be able to extrapolate where your users are from, that's, interesting. Most people are heavily focused in North America, especially when they're doing mobile apps and not mobile games. But we have interesting cases of developers that just found out they have 30% users in China or something like that, so that's interesting. And then it also extrapolate what are the other user interests of your segment, of your players.
Payers, yes, non-payers, meaning you create
create a custom event called in-app purchase, and then you look at the segment that only isolates those people. So you're going to create a segment of all your in-app purchasers and look at you know, what do they do differently. So for example, here you can see that the median session for in-app purchasers is longer. They have more sessions per day, and then you can restrict that to any kind of segment that you, any kind of event that you want. So if you only want the people that purchased, a set of 100 crops, you can isolate those specifically. There's other features that are pretty interesting, especially on the technical side. So this is what we call path flows, and I kind of mentioned it earlier, and I didn't have the graph ready here. So this is kind of interesting because it allows you to create events and then to look at what your users do for every following each event. So for example, start a session, then you have 50% of people that start play, 20% of people that do something else. So it's interesting to see how your users go, and you can go up to 10 levels down. So it's also really interesting to see, for example, what are the drop-offs in your app, and I have a slide that shows that a little bit better. The conversion tracking is really interesting. It's actually a feature that I think our developers don't use enough. What we can basically tell you is how much of your users are converting well to your other apps. The best way to promote your apps before advertising, before anything else, is to cross-promote your apps between each and everyone. So of course, that's if you have a paid and a free version, it's making sure that the people that have your free version are going to upgrade to the paid version. And then it's also if you have a million DAUs on one app, making sure that you leverage that base to promote your new apps. And I think the companies that have been really, really successful, and we see this in the charts, the companies that have been really successful have very good cross-selling rates. Meaning they're able often to move up to 50 to 60% of their user base through their new apps. So it's if you have a million DAU on one app, and on launch already on day two of your new app, you're already at 500,000 DAUs. You already have a pretty good start. So that's something that's interesting, and that you should look at. So basically, what I did is I kind of went over all the features that are in the Flurry SDK. There are more, but I think those are the most interesting. And then I kind of tried to identify, a few, the really useful things you can track in your app with the analytical features. Because I think right now the problem with the SDK often is that there's a lot of information, but after you've implemented, you also have to ask yourself, well, what am I trying to learn? What should I be looking at? And I think that's kind of important. On the first thing that's really important is making sure you have good user retention, just because your app is actually good and doesn't have any major drop-offs. So this is, as I said, the way to identify a drop-off. If you create an event, for example, enter email address, and then you have something like 60% of people that enter their email address, and then you have 40% of people that exit your app, that's not very good, because basically you're creating an action that's too intrusive and that's actually hurting your user retention. If you're losing 40% of your daily active users because of this app, of this event, you should probably implement it in a way that's less intrusive. The second kind of thing in that slide is the crash logs. We give you the crash logs for every crash that happens, so it often helps developers identify where the crashes are coming from on which device. So that's something that's interesting. On the device level, this is also following the fact that Apple was really mad at us, and I think they were kind of right. So I don't know if all of you know why exactly was really mad at us. I can tell you the little story if you want. So basically, something like a year and a half ago, a lot of the apps that had our SDK integrated in it were showing up really weird UPIDs, the device that we didn't know. We were like, we didn't understand what was going on. And there were all these rumors that Apple was about to launch a tablet, and so people people at our company put, you know, two and two together, and it was like, well, this must be the new tablet, they're beta testing it with our game, so, you know, and someone at Floyd decided it was a really good idea to publish a blog post on our blog saying Apple is releasing, you know, a new device, something that looks like a tablet, you know this because. So obviously, yeah, obviously they were really happy. But I think something good actually turned out of that because, you know, we got, our CEO Simon got an angry phone call, but we actually, you know, got to meet people at Apple and to talk with them, and now we have a much kind of better understanding, have a good relationship with them, you know, even if sometimes they do decisions that, you know, aren't always easy for us, at least there's communication, and it's always good to know that we're in the right direction. When there was the end of incentivized installs, for example, on iOS, we came up with a new product that's called Apps for Clips that allows to incentivize the viewing of a clip but not the download. And we talked with Apple and we're like, are you okay with this? And they were like, yes, as long as there's no incentivization of the download, we're fine with it. So in the end, it was good because it allowed us to, you know, get contacts and kind of have a good working relationship with them, which is important because you need to be able to communicate well with them. So the second thing I think that's really important with the Flurry SDK and something that we've really focused on in the Analytics 3.0 is who is your audience. So the first thing that we talked about is, you know, extrapolating the age and gender of the audience. So even if you don't collect that information, we can, you know, give you more information about that. Surprisingly, we found out that in social gaming, the users are more male and younger than what we would have thought they were going to be. We were expecting something that would be a little bit closer to Facebook, for example, you know, more female and more, you know, in the 40-45-year-old category. It's not really the case, so that's also interesting for us. And then you also want to kind of learn more information about the users that accomplish the actions that are important to you. And so that's something that's very customizable for your app. So some companies, for example, have mobile apps, and what they want with a mobile app is they want people to sign up to the website. So that's, you know, their mobile app is only a gateway to the website. So for that, you know, these companies, you know, I encourage them to create an event that, you know, input email address or register to the website, and then, you know, look at who are the users that do that. For traditional social gaming companies, obviously you wouldn't look at people that in-app purchase, because we've released a couple of blogs about that. You only have between 3 and 5% of your daily active users that will actually purchase something. But then when they purchase that item, they purchase a lot and with an average daily transaction, an average unique transaction, sorry, of $14. So basically you have all this audience, you know, that's very large, you have like millions of DAUs, but you only have 3% of the people, those people that are actually, you know, making you money. And so you really want to have the information about those 3% of people's, the whole information is useful. But you really want to know a lot about the people that are purchasing regularly. Same thing, heavy users, so we talked about that a little bit. Also, users that are social. So for example, maybe, you know, the user is not going to purchase anything, but he's going to post something on his Facebook wall, and he's going to, you know, end up referring someone who's going to be more useful to you. So that's also something important. And then I think also it's important to kind of, once you have those findings, once you have this information, is apply it to tune your app. And that's something that, you know, we've seen a lot I think from the Facebook world, and now it's, I think there's a consensus that that's the case on iOS, is that you don't really release an app anymore and then, you know, leave it alone. It's very true in gaming, and it's true in apps in general. You really want to, you know, observe what's going on, who are the people that are playing your app, and come back regularly and feed them content. So for example, if you realize that your in-app purchasers are mostly, you know, females in Asia between the age of 25 and 35, you really need to adapt the kind of in-app purchases you offer, or the kind of features that you offer, the levels of your characters that you bring in, because you want these people to stay engaged. And then, create an event that's called share the link on Facebook or share the link on Twitter. So it's basically creating a segment around a unique event.
Are you trying to do that in Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter replies? Yeah, they use it.
So that's also a problem, kind of. I mean, that's a problem with the iOS world in general, is that it's very, a lot of clients, for example, ask us, well, can you tell us how many people are playing our game that come from a Facebook link? So we can actually tell you the opposite. We can tell you how many of your players are going to share a link on Facebook, but we can't tell you the opposite. And the reason for that is just that the once you go through the App Store, everything that you had before, the cookies, you know, all the information is completely washed out. And so that's a bit frustrating. It's, you know, especially in the world today where, you know, we're getting to gaming that's completely cross-platform. You know, companies that are starting to release games where you can actually forward your Facebook gaming experience to iOS, iPad, and it's that unfortunately it's really hard for us to, you know, basically we have no information on what happened before you came into the app. But all the information we have starts at, you know, you open the app on your newer device. And then the last thing that we can kind of talk about is how we leverage all this analytical data as you know, a way to build an advertising model. So we leverage all the data that we collect. That means, you know, who are your users, what kind of other apps do they have on their device to target, you know, better recommendations. So on the acquisition side, that means that you, the advertisers are acquiring better users. They're acquiring users that, you know, have similar tastes, that are closer to the organic users that you have. On the publisher side, for monetization, this means that you know, you maximize the revenue that you have and you improve your CPM because the ad that we're showing to your user is targeted to that user. And then on the retention side, you know, you can re-engage the best users once you identify them. And I think that's the whole reasoning behind the Analyst 3.0 is that there's been a lot of, you know, studies and, you know, blog posts from us and from other people that show today that people actually spend more time in their mobile apps than they do on the web. And to create good advertising, you really need to create good targeting and good segmentation, because all the advertisers from Madison Avenue and, you know, the car makers, all these, they're really interested in mobile advertising, but it has to come with mobile segmentation, because that's how they do their business now. On TV print, you can't ask an advertiser to blindly do a campaign. So all these features that we're building now in the analytics, hopefully will make a more intelligent and more targeting advertising network in the future.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I understand your advertising network. So
yes.
You guys are a mobile ad network. So yes. I, as an agency, can come and buy on Flurry Network. And your profiles are created. That's
yes.
One way. And then sort of the other way, which is publishers have your network, you know, on their particular site.
Yes.
Is there any model missing?
No. So basically, you have so everything works on a CPI basis. So cost per install. So in that, we're different. For example, from iAd or AdMob. And yet, advertisers can create acquisition campaigns based on the segments that they want. For example, you know, if you identify that your best segment is you know, female user between the age of 25 to 35, you can. This is not really available right now, but it will be available in about a month and a half. Acquire users that look like that. And on the publisher side, there's two kind of interesting things. There's monetization of your actual user base. So on iOS, on Android also a lot, just because the in-app purchasing is not as good on iOS, not as strong on Android as it is on iOS. And then there's also retargeting users that you had in the past that haven't left your game, that haven't come back in a long time. Also, all these features are going to be available soon, in about a month and so on.
So it's cost per install, pure
So you have to minimum bid.
I only pay, so I might say I'm going to pay $5 per install, and I only pay when it sells.
Yeah. So it's, if you pay $5 per install, you're going to get a lot of users. That's very high.
Yeah. So what are your average?
Right, the average bid right now is 0.75 cents. 0.75 dollars.
So 75 cents.
75 cents.
Okay. 0.075.
Yeah.
75 cents.
Yeah. No. It's 0.75 cents. Sorry. This is where not being named English.
75 cents. All right. 75 cents.
Sorry.
75 cents.
Yeah.
75 cents.
Yeah. Sorry. This is where.
Sorry. Thank you.
Start speaking French.
So, yes. If you have a cross-platform app like that's on Android and iPhone,
yes.
Is it possible right now to combine those two to use in your dashboard or these separate apps in Flurry?
So you can right now only if you you can right now if you only have two apps. What you could do right now to do it. So basically, in your company view, you're going to see all of your users together. Like across all of your apps. And then if you want to target specifically two different apps, you would create two segments, one of them being your Android app and one of them being your iOS app, and then combine them.
Cool, okay.
Yes.
So I have two related questions. One, like, it sort of spurred off something you said earlier about something that you wish more that developers took advantage of. It's like, I guess one question I have is, what are developers doing with your analytics that I think is working really well? Like, what is the thing they, and then like, what's the other thing that you wish that they would take advantage of that they're not taking advantage of?
So I think what developers are doing right now that is, you know, good is kind of looking at, you know, everything around AI purchasing. So I think that's something that everyone's working with pretty well, just because developers understand that it's their main source of revenue. So everything around creating segments around in-app purchasing, looking at who your users are that are doing in-app purchasing, that's also something that's pretty interesting. On what I wish developers were doing more, I see a lot of developers that don't have events set up, and that's a really a shame, because I think the Flurry SDK, a lot of the interesting things, require to have events set up. So events set up. I think one of the features we were talking about was the upselling, cross-selling. A lot of developers don't know that it's in there. So that's definitely something that's interesting. I think right now that's all that comes to mind. Yeah, I'm sure some of the other things will come back.
I know that right now the geography view uses Flash, and plans on making that more mobile friendly for
iPad
and such.
Yeah, I heard something about it being released next week, something like that. I heard that there was a lot of the features on the dashboard that were working on iPad, for example, which is kind of a shame. So yes, I know that there is.
That's one of my favorite features. I use that a lot.
Yeah.
To see how the spread of my app, where it's hitting.
Yeah, it's an interesting, one of the things that I really like, and also something that you really should do with segmentation, is combine the segments. So if you want to look, for example, at your heavy users that have accomplished an in-app purchase that are based in China but speak English. So that's something that's really interesting. And that's really interesting for Asian countries. If you have a big presence in Asia, it's really interesting to look at, which language your users are playing. And for example, we find that some games that have really big presence in Hong Kong, for example, or in Central Korea or China. External development projects. So PlaySell is a French company, and that's how I landed in the US. A lot of a lot of developers, like publishers, were asking us to implement Flurry.
Were there some insights that you got in your real life from Flurry that made changes in React and some?
I mean, in Flurry?
Flurry or Flurry, by using Flurry, what were the insights that you personally
made changes? Yeah, so a couple of examples when we, for example, had kind of guessed the audience a little bit wrong, for example, where we thought we were more in a female-driven game, and then it turned out that it wasn't really the case, also with age, for example. One example in particular where there's one item, an in-app purchase item that sold very well, so they kind of looked at the demographic on that item and found out that there was this core base of players who were based in Asia that were purchasing a lot, and that kind of redefined the whole design of the in-app purchase items that they were planning. And then we focused that to make in-app purchases that looked more like that one. So that was something that was interesting too.
And did that work?
Yeah, it did. I think for in-app purchasing, a lot of the findings that you get are pretty relevant. I think so. I'm trying to think of other reasons. I think in general, you really need like an analytical tool in general. I think, and you know, we're not a company where we ask for exclusives. We've had clients that have implemented us and other networks at the same time, for example, AppSolar. So you know, if you have enough space to put that in your app, the SDK, we just released a new version of the SDK. It's a modular SDK now, meaning that you only use the part of the SDK that you use. So if you're only an analytics client and you don't use, for example, before you acquire users or monetize them, SDK that's really small.
You mentioned that some companies are using the app to refer to a website.
Yeah.
Do you have an example of that?
Of a company that does that?
Well, you don't have a company, but just give an example.
Yeah. Well, for example, in dating websites, you see that a lot. For example, you know, the mobile app, the mobile apps are important just in terms of usage, but everything, you know, all the paying features and everything go through the website. So a lot of people, you know, want to look at having a mobile app. It's true, for example, when you have companies that do advertising through mobile. So for example, they're going to create mobile advertising campaigns. People are going to download the app, but the ultimate goal is to get them to the website where they will, you know, purchase a subscription, for example, or something like that. One of the things that you can look at, for example, when you have the SDK implemented is, you know, payment, for example, how many people pay through their phones and everything like that. So I think right now the usage is very strong on mobile, but the payment is still, you know, I think stronger on the websites. So that's why a lot of people, you know, will want you to register on the mobile and then try and get you to visit the website more often.
HTML5,
we're thinking of it, we're not doing it right now. Right now, the bet that we kind of made 4 or 5 years ago was to go native. Not all companies did that. And for example, we don't really provide any services on, you know, mobile web in general. HTML, we are thinking of it just because so many of our clients now are moving in that direction. I don't really know. I know it's in the plans, but I don't have any kind of firm answer on that yet. But hopefully it will. Yes. Maybe I can address the UDA question now. Hoping you have. So kind of the answer around all the UDITM kind of information. So Flurry does use UDIT we use it a lot in the advertising part of our business. So for example, an example of that is, you know, in the cost per install networks where you have rewards, for example, where you reward a user for downloading an app that an advertiser has advertised through his app, we use the UDIT to know to which user to give a reward, for example. So we do use UDIDs. We don't collect any PII, So what we collect right now is usage about what people do in the app, for example. So all the information that was right here in the app, what other apps they have, how much time they spend in your app, which events they do, which, you know, what events do they accomplish. All this, we don't collect, you know, the name of the person, you know, related to the PID. We don't collect the email address. We don't collect social security numbers. We don't collect addresses. We don't collect. So we don't really collect anything that that is related to the PII. We do just because the market right now and the situation right now is there's a lot of kind of thinking around these issues. We do encourage our developers to include the use of third-party services that track UPIDs in their terms of service. So what you know, the standard policy for us right now is, you know, in your terms of service, in your privacy policy, include the fact that you use Flurry and let people opt out if they wish. And that way you're completely compliant with all the kind of rules and laws. It's not legal to track PII, we just don't do it. And clearly, I think the move on Apple's side right now is
PII,
personal identifiable information.
Thank you.
I think the move on Apple's side right now is to they want to adopt a really firm stance on privacy, which I think is good. Yes, sorry.
You can finish, then I'll ask.
Is to adopt a really firm stance on policy, on the privacy policy. What this means for us is that we're going to have to find new ways to get that, you know, information. So new identifiers that aren't going to be the ones provided by Apple. The ones provided by Apple were convenient because they were universally used, but they're not really better or different than any personal identifier that we could assign to hackers. And so we're going to move towards that. It doesn't really affect the analytics part of the business at all. It doesn't really affect 90% of the advertising that we have at Flurry. It does affect a small part of the advertising that we have, as I was saying, kind of especially the rewarded parts of the. So we're just going to move towards other kind of identifiers. And also lastly, this is something that our engineers have said, is deprecate doesn't really mean that it's disappearing. It just means that in, you know, a future that is, you know, near or not really near, it won't be really used anymore. So we definitely feel that we still have, you know, a little bit of time, you know, before the PID stops completely, stops functioning. And I mean, this is something that all developers are going to have to deal with, not only advertising networks. So for example, I know that a lot of people use UDIDs, for example, for users that have several, the same game on several devices. For example, iPhone, iPad, they use IDA to basically track sessions. Now it means that people are going to have to log in, you know, through email address and things like that, create accounts, which is a little bit more difficult. So it's going to make things a little bit more difficult. It's not. It's definitely not going to affect the analytics part really that much. We're just going to have to find a new substitute to the UDID.
Well,
a
simple app
can
create a random number,
something
that like that solves.
Yeah.
The UID is a special means that two different application corporations. You get an age of one app and then apply it to another.
Yeah.
And so if you create another form of doing that, that's what you're
you're not going to be able to. Well, both apps will have to have the same identifier.
That's
hopefully we'll manage to create to create something that's as universally used as the
UDID. And then Apple has their ad network and all their traffic. Do you think they're going to continue to use the UDID to get an unfair advantage over everybody?
I mean, I think they probably are. I mean, through IAD, I think it would be a shame on their advantage, on their side, not to do it. I really don't think that their banning the UDID has anything to do with trying to eradicate the advertising networks. Right now, I think, like, publishers have suffered already a lot through the end-of-incentivized installs, and I think I think they understand that advertising is an important part of making revenue and monetizing for developers. So I think it's definitely something more related to the privacy issue, which is good. So I think on the advertising side, there's going to have to be a little bit of reflection on that. I mean, it's really, really new. I don't think anyone has really had time to think about it that much, and in which case I'm not really the best person to do that, because I know our engineers and everything are working on that.
On Android, Motorola released a series of bugs and calls saying you can't have our, right? So a lot of people had to deal with that issue.
Yeah. And so, for example, also from what I understand, on the Android there is going to be ID. We've also already done that to basically assign different identifiers that we've created ourselves to track all the information in the different apps. So this is already something that we're doing on Android, and we have all the services that we have on iOS, we have on Android. So I think we're just going to move towards that kind of communication.
I had a question.
Something about extrapolating demographic data, such as age, sex,
yes, okay. So the way that we do it in the SDK, so were you here earlier? Okay, that was the time. So basically what we do to extrapolate the gender, age, and the location, it's a lot of users. We're present right now in 98% of smartphones. So there's a high probability that the user that's in your app has, forwarded his information in another app that's in the network on his phone, for example. So that's the case, for example, for a lot of the social networking apps where people require you to, create a very small profile to log in. So if we have that information available, we use it to, if we know that it's the same user, we use it to extrapolate the demographic and the age in Europe, and then the rest is extrapolated through an algorithm that I can't really tell you that much about, but if you would like more information, I can ask someone for more validation. But I know that it's something that we've been working for almost a year, creating the algorithms. And I was saying earlier, we kind of benchmark the results with the results of our developers, and they say that it's fairly accurate. With the exception of certain categories that I was saying. For example, the 55 plus age is very hard to extrapolate. They don't use any social networking apps. They have pages that are a little bit affected. For example, so often they download apps for their children. So it kind of and for example, on iPad, it's much harder also because you have several users using the same device. It's not as much of a question. Sorry.
No, it's okay. So if the device ID is encrypted, can you still use Query to do some analytics, but obviously not getting the demographic information?
I'm not sure about that, actually. I'll write down your question if you want to give me your card and I'll get back to you.
Thanks.
I know that we also hatch the UDIDs so that, for example, developers can identify, specifically target one UDID specifically. For example, we don't let you get the information about one UDID specifically. Can't tell you this UDID specifically does this. What we do is we use the UDID and then collect the information and then hash the information and give it to you as a an estimate of the whole segment. So right now we don't allow developers to get information about one UDID in particular.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, if the developer has already encrypted that one, but I'll drop you a note.
Yes, I'm not really sure about that.
Is there an API that access the analytics?
Yes, there is. We encourage people to use the SDK in general, but if you want to, we will.
On the website.
Yes.
Northwest-based Seattle startup. product, which is based on relationships with carriers, which is one of the things that people forget is different about mobile, because we spend a lot of time browsing about our carriers. But they actually can help us provide more information about who's using sites and apps and those sort of things. And so please welcome Lily.
Out there or just that audience?
How big is that audience? What's that audience? That's a breakdown. It's
so apps and browsing are two facets, just like men and women are two facets, just like age groups are both facets, and so on. And then we get down to the technology measuring mobile's hard because we can't just go and build up a million person panel like they do on the DC space. There isn't one thing, we can't just build it once for Windows and roll it out. If you're not aware, Comscore and Nielsen on the PC side don't measure Mac users. They just ignore them. For a long time, they didn't measure business users. They went to architects and they ignore them. For a long time, for 15 years, the online measurement space was home PCs shared by a bunch of people. It was actually measuring the group of people, the household, that use the PCs. Now they're starting to actually try and get the rest of the graph. We don't have that ability in mobile to take those shortcuts. Phones are used all over the place. Kind of a one-to-one representation of people. But we don't also know how Windows. We can't just build a meter once, roll it on, and then have it to be done with. And I'll talk about how we get our data. But we can't use cookies either, which is how a lot of problems are solved in online space. Cookies don't work in mobile. They work somewhat, but they don't work sufficiently. You get issues even if I was told for years you could this problem will go away and we'll get really good browsers. We did get really good browsers, and they don't allow their cookies. The Safari browser don't do that. Then we have issues of privacy, because these are personal devices. I hand this to my kids once in a while, but pretty much this is my phone, it's tied to me, and if we figure out that it's my phone, I'm not tracking me, as opposed to tracking anonymous people. It opens up big areas of privacy, and we live in a country where the companies that run mobile networks are highly regulated, and privacy is huge amounts of laws, huge space in the law that regulates them on what they can and cannot do. And that starts to spill over into Apple and Google and everyone else in this space as well. And lastly, and not unimportant, I don't throw it on the end because it's unimportant, mobile's a new medium. And you'll see this starts out early in the presentation, which I'll do later, which is there are five media. There's TV, radio, print, online, which is PCs, and now mobile. And I'll defy anyone to say that mobile and PCs is the same thing. It's a new space, it has different use cases, right? Different entities playing, and there are a lot of mobile apps, but it's new. And as a new media, we don't know what to measure yet. We don't actually know what the best measurement is of audience. And so since it's new and we don't know what to measure, it's hard to dive right in and measure exactly what people want. Because people are asking for a lot of different. Alright, there's three major methodologies used to measure media. Number one is surveys. So this is how mobile's been measured for the past 6 years. There were two companies that started about 6 years ago. One's called M-Metrics, one's called Calafia. They're now Comscore Mobile and Nielsen. And their main product for measuring what goes on in the digital space of mobile is surveys. So they took a panel of a few thousand people and they asked them 200 questions per month, 200 questions per quarter. What did you do last month? And just examples would be, did you use the browser on your phone? If you said yes, then they ask these series of questions. Well, did you read news on the browser or on your phone? Yes. All right. And of course, they don't ask if you said no. All right. Which of these brands did you use to get news on your phone? And they'll list 30 brands. And you'll check off CNN that you've heard, check off some others that you've heard of. You won't check off the little thing that's on the bottom you've heard. And if the service that you've used was not on the list, you won't answer that service because it's not on the list. So there, okay at measuring the top 300-400 sites that show up on these lists. Very hard to rank between them because they're asking them down to the silos. So you can't really compare the numbers they get for CNN and the numbers they get for ESPN. One is news and one is sports. And you can't compare that to E-Online with entertainment. You can't compare it to one of the actual news. And it's just a few thousand people trying to measure about 200. So that's not the best methodology, but it's better than none, which is why it went through. Their main goal was to put meters on the phones, which is how Comscore and Nielsen do PCs. They have a million people who have spyware on their PCs, and people know this, chose to do this. trying to do the same thing in mobile, it's just really hard. Just getting a meter to run on an iPhone is hard. Getting a meter to run on Android is not too hard. But getting a million people to do it is next to impossible right now. Right? So you can do that for a few thousand people, and so they and us and some others are doing that as well. And someone actually just got popped and does nothing with meters. Arbitron just bought a company that does mobile meters. Now, the hardest possible way to measure this and the way that gives you the most accuracy is what ground truth does, and that's what's called census or SAN, giant SAN. There's actually no new term in the industry. We tend to call it SAN. So what we did is we went to wireless operators and we said, you have logs of what all your customers are doing on the mobile web. Can we have a copy? And there was a little bit of messaging wrapped around that. And so some of them had said yes. Not all of them, but some of them have said yes. And so we have data on the actual number right now. It's tens of millions of Americans. And exactly what they did on their phone, every request of their browser to every web server. It comes out to be on the order of 10-ish billion records per day. About a terabyte per day. And so we talk through that and we count up what people did. So we don't have to project out from 10,000 people to it's about 125 million per month. We count up, let's say it's 30 million, 40 million people, and then we munch it a little bit to make it more accurate, and then we multiply by a factor of 1. So our data is A, more accurate because we're capturing more people, and B, we can dive way into this data. You can ask me, all right, what are the people who are male in this age group from this region of the country who have visited ESPN in the past day or past hour? What did they do? Did they go to this, or did they search for these terms, or what ads did they see? And I have enough data that I can slice into that granularity and still have an answer. And clearly, you can't do that if you only have 10,000 people in the survey, right? If you just do male female, you're down to 5,000. If you do age groups, you're down to 500. If you do ESPN, you're down to 12. And then you can't slice it in further, 12 people on the other. So, you know, we feel really strongly that having this big data set gives us accurate data and gives us better data.
So, to be clear, are these logs, the traffic that's run through using my carrier as a data service?
Yes.
And so when I'm connected locally to my Wi-Fi in my home,
Depending on your carrier, that is true or not.
Okay.
Some carriers had the prescient knowledge to pass everything through their system anyway. They didn't do it for this reason, though. They did it so that if you go to any of their services, they still know who you are. Authentication is a problem. Cookies don't work. IDs are kind of tricky on these phones. Some carriers actually don't know the ID of your phone because it's pops in first, right? So in order to solve that problem, they simply send all the traffic through to their system. And then their system can figure out who you are based on yourself. Yeah.
So a little bit of an issue.
Yeah. Get a little bit. It's not easy. A, it's not easy to work with operators. Period. It's not easy to work with them in this space. And then when you dive down into the details of getting, you know, what are they logging and what are they not logging, and how do you get access to them, gets trickier. We'll solve those problems for tens of millions of people. Right? Not every carrier, but another carrier. So really, the only practical approach, though, the problem with just relying on the sample is it doesn't tell you how many people there are in total. Right? So I can have data on all but one carrier, and if you tell me everything that all but one carrier did, it would tell me how many people. Therefore, it wouldn't tell me how many people in total visited it. So you have to use some hybrid approach. You have to do something besides the sample to get the totals. And there are deals made in these carriers. Right? So I don't know how many people are on Verizon, but you probably have Bing as your search box on Verizon if you did a deal with Microsoft. So if most of my data, if a large piece of my sample were from Verizon, the big number is going to be too high. Deals like that happen in every carrier. I got issues with AccuWeather, I got issues with CNN, I got issues with Google and others. The because the data sets are biased somewhat based on their deals. And we have to unbias that in order to figure out the biases we can get the data from elsewhere. So if we take care of that, we just call that measurement science. We take the sample of all the data and we fix it using the meters and the service. So, everyone here is in mobile, I suppose. We're at the mobile corporate show. I don't always do this in front of a mobile office. We're all in mobile because it's growing. It's clearly going to pop out because we're running out of people. The carriers are all saying we're going to move on to connected devices. So, we're all going to own 6 devices that are all apps. And they'll give us a bucket of minutes and whatnot, but a bucket of bytes or some form of. A way to share that. They want us all to sign up multiple times, but clearly, in terms of people, we're just about out of people who can sign up for cell phone. Right? This is a really old chart, and it's off of it. We're a bit north of that, anyway, to be in our and one thing that's hard to remember, you gotta take a step back in this industry. Here we are in 2011. In 87, they just made fun of this in the sequel, right? In 87, that was the phone, right? Lasted for like a half an hour, and it wasn't until, it was from then until 2007 that mobile was growing, but nobody cared, right? Nobody really cared. There wasn't a lot of money to be made. I can point out of all the mobile companies that jammed at, the only one that cashed out. I think that sold to EA Mobile at the time I was in. And then in 2007, this magical phone appeared, and all of a sudden, everybody cared. Basically, all the VCs woke up. Silicon Valley woke up and said, hey, look, something's real here. And also that year, the Kindle came out. Okay, those are coincident devices. And so we've been chugging along with iPhones and now Androids, right, the demise of everything else, watching this growth curve go up. And it's also really hard to believe that it was just over a year ago that the iPad came out. They announced it in April and it was available in June. And they've sold, I lost the count of the number, not because 35 million on the right? So we went from no tablets in the world, no tablets that anyone cared about, to billions of dollars worth, tens of millions of these tablets in a year. And what everyone in this room should be wondering about is that the device I should be working on? Building for is that the key device now? What's the trade-off between tablet usage and smartphone usage? Due to tablets, the smartphone usage go down. Right? Going back to the complexity of mobile, tablets are mobile. I count tablets as mobile. I've seen stats that say most of the use of tablets is at home. It doesn't matter. People are walking around using these things at home. Pick them up in one room, bring them to the other room. It's mobile. So I have to measure now people who have both. The difference of behavior between people who have both and people who have one or the other. And to do that, 3G and Wi-Fi, and in most cases, that Wi-Fi traffic doesn't go through carriers. So I'm working on how to track these things using the other methodologies, mostly meters.
So you're solving that idea?
Yeah, we have solved that. Alright, and in the quick little 10 minutes here, I'm going to walk out of data phone. I'm going to do it kind of quickly, just to show some things that are measurable. Some of this came from my staff, most of it did not, but things I find interesting. Where are smartphones used? Right, so in terms of mobile data services, where are smartphones used? Big surprise, it's actually used at home. Right? People thought of smartphones as high-end devices, businessmen on the go, right? I get billing zip codes, but not current location. The meters capture current location, but the web logs are not. What are these people doing with the phones? Right, it's a big Uber question. Right? We know where, you know, we have some idea where they're using them, but what are they using them for? This came off of one of those meters. And the surprising piece here was the voice was only 27% of the time spent on the phone. That was the call on the phone. Right? But this is clearly shrinking because it needs to be 100%. It's down to 27%, messaging was bigger. Right? And the other box, which is data services, is even bigger. And so you can pick any of these wedges and you can start asking questions, right? Again, it works. What did they do down these wedges? The other direction to go, that's just one way to go. The other way to go is to say, okay, for my audience, right? And in this case, the audience question was teams. For teams, what do they do? Right? Just because they have a phone and I have a phone doesn't mean we use the phones the same way. Right? Certainly my use of my smartphone is different than my parents. They just got some smartphones, they're really happy that it moved to the car. That was the end of the day.
Do you think the 16-year-old text messaging data is just an anomaly because you see growth from every age from, it's like 13, and then there's this slight dip at 16, and then it goes up again at 17?
Yeah, it's probably they had, he's not allowed to ask questions to people under 18, so I don't know where they got that. You're not allowed to survey people under 18.
That's when they can actually drive, so they're actually.
Yeah. So my guess is they had three people. They had eight people at 15, yeah. Three people at 16, and 12 people at 17 when they're able to.
That represents the time it takes them to learn how to text and drive at the same time.
There you go. This is one I love that I pulled up. This is an eMarketer's study and then projections. This came out in 2010, and it said how many people are using the mobile internet. So now we're in 2011. They said 101. I measured 125 already. This curve is not steep enough. Right? It comes back down to we don't know how many. We didn't know how many people used the mobile internet last year. Right? Now we do. The number were assumed to be lower than they really are. And it's growing fast. And some of the factors here, they didn't expect half the phones sold to be smartphones when they did the model. That's where we are now. I think I skipped that. So now we got to some graduate funds. What do people do on the web? So the first product that we put out was just focused on mobile web. As I said, measure all of mobile's hard to get one thing first. Start with web, next comes web app. And what we measured was that social networking was mobile, right? By far. And everything else was a small sliver. So this is in terms of page views, and not in terms of audience, because you can't do audience as well. And a few other things came out of here. So you know, lots of companies that we sell to do news and sports and advertising and other media. Well, that's nice, but they're 1% of all the traffic. They grew up to 2.6% when we started looking at everything this fall. These other widgets are starting to grow. Social networking is slowly shrinking. It's huge. And when you look into that, you find that it's Facebook. And MySpace still exists. It does. It's number two or three in mobile. It's starting to fade in mobile as well. It disappeared into mobile phones for a while. Right? You heard all the hype about MySpace and now. It shifted over. Their audience uses a lot of mobile phones. Their audience is urban youth. And so they're doing their internet on phones instead of PCs.
What's computer to the internet for an internet graph?
That consumes email, instant messaging, the best title of the category, that's what it's called. So all of email. And we actually split things around. We'll take Facebook and we'll measure the inbox portion of Facebook. The inbox portion will get put into computers, get put into email, which is a subcategory of computers and the internet. Some things that we found were that Facebook inbox was more popular for people and page views than every other mail service. That's how strong the social network is.
The social networking sites have much better metrics about what's going on. So, find is they don't want to buy our data because they already can log in. So they already know what's going on.
Right.
But they don't share.
Do they share what's there?
No. It's very rare for anyone to share data. That's why companies like mine exist. Pursuing like, right? And the number one request of every customer that comes, nearly every customer that comes to Brownsburg is, I'd like to know how I'm doing. And these three other sites. And here are three other sites, three other brands. And I have no idea what they're doing anymore. I know they have a website, but I don't know how popular it is. So yeah, it's a new medium. So companies are slowly jumping into the media, and they don't know if their competitor has done that yet or not. And just because you can throw up a website doesn't mean you have 10,000 or 100,000 or a couple thousand people showing up. It looks the same. So we answered that question. A few more. Here's some top sites. So here are these sites that people are visiting. I think there's one bucket on this list. But it's Google and Facebook and YouTube. Some media is going up. And some things that are interesting is you get sites like Mixer and MobiTV. And if you go down further in the list, you get Mofo Space, which is sort of by name. The Cellular Fund and Energy. You get all these sites that are mobile specific, that are startups that started in the mobile space back with mobile before iPhone. And depending on where you are in the list, it's about half of the sites. So you look at the top 100, and almost half of the sites are these mobile-centric sites. And again, it points to this mantra you're saying, it's in the media. New companies showed up, they found a niche, they found an audience that wanted to do things on mobile phones. And they jumped on it, and they used AdMob and Millennial and Quattro when they were very independent to grow their audience via ads. And it actually worked. Now, no one's heard of any of these companies, because they didn't even know they were on the list. They didn't know they made the top 100. Because no one had that list. It wasn't a survey answer. Jumping into, again, the graduate report, what you can do on our system is you click on one of these sites, and then you'll see a trend line, and see some subsections, and then see some actionable reports here. We get upstream, downstream, and similar reports. So for any given site, given this complete sample we have, we'll get to a second, we can also see not only what sites people visited and any pattern of any site, we can see the flow between sites. So another click stream. Right, so we can see where people were before Facebook and we see where people were after Facebook and we make a cap of that. And we do this for different sites. So again, when someone comes to us and says, well, how am I doing versus my competitor, we not only tell them how they rank, we tell them the difference in audience composition, we tell them where the audience, the difference in upstream and downstream audience as well. So it's usually pointing to the fact that one of these competitors has found some secret in mobile that brings them more customers. Found some site to partner with, or some ad network to work with, or some combination thereof to get more audience. And we help them like that to everyone else in that industry. Right? Similarly, downstream means we're on the audience too. And so it's useful to a site to know what happened. You know, how long many pages did they visit on my site? And then what do they do next? Right? We can start to think about ways to get that audience back and people get more often. Get back on.
And can you break out the Facebook app versus website visits?
I will, but I can't at the moment. Right? So I'm not reporting. Again, in a different direction, what's the audience composition of that site? So what's the age breakdown? What's the gender breakdown, the education, the income, and any different combinations there? And so we do this in the web today, and we also do a product that I don't have time to talk about in the app space, where we integrated demographics from carriers and share that with app developers. So if you're an app developer, you'd like to know what your audience composition is, you come to us. Won't specifically tell you what it is on Verizon and Sprint and AT&T. Not almost all wrong. Right. So again, that's my can of worms. And how much more time do you want me to go?
I think
questions at this point.
Okay.
We need to wrap up.
I don't think that picture.
Okay, any other questions? Yes.
So like when somebody comes to you and says, compare me to my top three competitors, what does that cost?
Oh, so the question was when someone comes and asks for me and my competitors' support, we only sell one thing today in Syndicate. We sell an annual subscription to the service. It's not so cheap. So, you know, it's a new company, new space. We're just tacking down the list of big companies now. We have some customers, like, we had that model when they were independent. Most of the ad net, other people lab networks, companies like Selling.com have subscribed. But we know we need a product that is kind of like Heat.com at that price for everyone else. We'll get there. We just have to.
And do you have interest from people who are doing like publishing, like newspapers and magazines and stuff like that?
What was the first part of that?
Do you have interest from like the media, basically?
We do have interest from the media, and we're trying to answer. They have some different questions than some of the marketers. And so as we go through and talk to different companies, we have to fine-tune the mix of reports and problems. The question was what percentage of the carriers do we have? We don't actually disclose anything about the source of our data or number of carriers or anything besides saying it's tens of millions. That's as far as I can go. On the app side, right, that's on the website. On the app side, we talk about three public announcements we made where we are integrated with Verizon, AT&T, and Sprint on trading app usage for demographics. Gives clues, but it doesn't answer your question. Yeah.
So in a lot of the charts you showed, there's traffic from like CNN, ESPN, and also other apps, as well as you mentioned email is only a small percentage. But most phones integrate your email into your phone of those. Is that data in the data set that you were showing, or is that displayed separately?
Okay, so the question was, when email is integrated in the phone, is it showing up here? So this is specifically web. So you have to be in a browser, and then we see what you're doing in this case. To capture a built-in email or any apps requires a different methodology, which we're in the midst of rolling out. Well, methodology rolled out in the midst of gathering the data. And the goal is to have a set of reports that then splits it out. We do see on that on our meters, for instance, how much time people are spending in email. We don't see the actual email, we don't see how many they read, time spent, number of times they went viewed it, and so forth. That gets captured there for that in the app report. Any more questions? So the question is, do we find major differences between app usage and web usage? Except for Facebook. That's the one commonality. Things are vastly different. Vastly different. Angry Birds doesn't really show up on the web report. It shows up dramatically in the app report. It is an unbelievably popular game. And few games show up on the web report, but gaming is a huge part of app usage. Even in this, in the two mode, these two modalities, you get different services that are popular. And there's lots of things people do in apps that just aren't done in the web and vice versa. Yes, so the question is the New York Times web and app users different? I'm sure there are, but I don't know.
Are you tracking device trends as well? So how many the fluctuation of Android users versus iPhone versus BlackBerry versus...
Okay, question is that we're tracking devices. Internally, we are tracking devices. So again, the sample data set, I didn't go through all the details, but it includes a few
field that tells us exactly which device is being used. But since we don't disclose where our data sources come from, I don't then disclose publicly anything about devices. Even the mix of platforms should give away where I get my data from. So we plan on doing that in the future, but we're not doing that as well. All right. Thank you very much. So I'm Jason. I help organize Mobile Portland. And I just want to go through a few slides before we get the panel started here. This is sort of our normal breakdown of things. We meet once a month. We meet on the fourth Monday of the month at 6 p.m. Talk about mobile, and we're platform agnostic. We cover a variety of different topics. What we try to do is we try to have one topic per quarter that is technical, one topic per quarter that's marketing, business, that sort of thing. This would be one of those. And one topic that's social, some sort of how mobile is impacting the world, how it's being used to contribute to some sort of social good, those sorts of things. This month, for the first time, we also did afternoon sessions, so good in depth to give the panelists an opportunity to talk more about what the products are, and also to give people who are interested a chance to learn more about what they were doing. And I think it turned out really, really well. It was nice to see we had about 45 people here for that event. Really good. How many people are here for the first time? How many? Awesome. Thank you very much. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. Like, we have like 1,000 people on the mailing list, and but on a month-to-month basis, we're sort of consistently getting new people. If you're interested in future events, if you're not signed up, there's an announcements-only list on mobileportland.com. So you'll get two emails a month, one announcing the event, one reminding you about the event. Or you can join the Google group, which is open for people to do everything but spam or recruit people to other cities. That is not something to think about. But otherwise, you can join the Google group, ask questions, get assistance, post job postings, all that sort of stuff. I want to go through some upcoming events. Of course, the stuff we've got going on today. If you're into mobile web, there's a really great conference in Nashville. It's actually been my favorite conference. I spoke there in April of this year. It's mid-September, Breaking Development Conference, and the speaker lineup is fantastic. And then we've got Android user groups, and there's actually, I think, a CocoaHeads user group, although their Google group is down right now. I'm not sure what exactly is going on, so if anyone knows, talk to me, because I'm curious what's going on with that group. And then, of course, we've got the next meeting on the fourth Monday of September. There's also an Android conference that O'Reilly is putting on for the first time. And if you use a discount code, I guess Android 11FE, Mobile Portland is what it stands for. So you can remember, you get $200 off registration. That's down in the Bay Area in the beginning of October. Upcoming topics. In September, we're going to be looking at nonprofit organizations. And I'm looking for people who might be able to speak on that, because I have not been able to round up people who are local, who are working with mobile phones and using them with nonprofits. I've got one company, and that may be enough to put one foot, but if not, then we'll shift to another topic. But I really love that something that's, you know, talking about how people are using mobile phones in other countries and things of that nature. And then October, advertising, and then November, we may not have a meeting because of Thanksgiving. I want to take a moment to thank our sponsors. Is there any urban airship that wants to pitch anything? Sasha? All right.
Absolutely. Sasha Mason, Director of Product Server Airship. We're hiring like mad. So if you are a client developer, Android, Windows, anything in your past, or we will hire you. support engineers, QA engineers, operations engineers, platform engineers, requisitions open for all of the products. So, urge you to apply. It's a great group of people. We're happy to have everybody here.
You get to work in a great office space. You've got great neighbors.
Possibly. I don't know
anything
about that.
Harsh. All right. But we are very happy and proud to be involved with Mobile Portland. really happy to be involved. And Ozlot is a technology consulting company, also looking for developers. And I just want to put a plug in here. What unusual position? Looking for individuals with Android or Java, like system level, so lower level embedded type systems for an Android system. And anybody's lower level, please come talk to myself or Will back there.
Yes, thank you. I just, Lynn's suggestion and actually contribution is the reason we had Nicholas Booth to meet tonight. So, after 3 years of putting up with the fact that I've been treating it like a fat frat party and only delivering chips and beer, we actually have Booth, which is pretty awesome. And then my company's Buffalo, we organize events and help in many ways. My coworkers unfortunately know that the fourth Monday of every month that they just get tapped to do whatever random stuff needs to be done. So thank you guys. Okay, so I want to take a moment and see if anyone has job openings or announcements, and keep it brief. We want to get through it very quickly. Raise your hand. Okay, go ahead and shout it out.
SpotMetrics looking for project managers. We do consultation work, but we're also working on pretty cool augmented reality projects. SpotMetrics. 3DAR is our toolkit. It's an iPhone toolkit. We also need Android developers to support it over iOS.
So I'm from Startup Weekend, Portland. We're just announcing that we locked down our location, which is going to be at Puppet Labs this year. It's going to be October 13th through the 15th, and Urban Airship signed on to sponsor us as well. So you can go on the website right now. And you can do early registration. Registration is going to be open up until that weekend. So, yeah.
Startup weekend, October 13th, 15th, is that
what it is? I believe it's the 13th.
13th, 15th, Puppet Labs, sign up. Startup weekend, Portland? How is it? Portland?
It's, I think it's portland.startupweekend.com.
Portland.startupweekend.com. Okay. Oh, you were just putting your hand here. Anyone else? All right. I have one more thing before we do this to give you sort of the monthly update on the device lab. We are fully incorporated. We've had our first board meeting. If you go and you do a search for corporation documents, you will find Mobile Portland, which is very gratifying. And the board is meeting on Thursday afternoon to start planning, putting together the business plan for the device lab so that we can start approaching the sponsors meeting for that. So, things are moving forward. Clap when the thing's done. Until then, it's just like, just steps.
We need to build morale.
Sorry. I want the device lab. I don't want this corporation lab. So, and for those who don't know, we're trying to build a community device lab where people in the city will be able to come in and test on a variety of mobile devices, and that's a big initiative for us this year. So I am very, very pleased to have a panel here to talk about mobile analytics. This is a topic that was suggested last August, and it took a while to get it onto the schedule. It's a topic that I think not enough people have really thought through the differences between what they're doing for analytics for the web versus what's necessary for mobile. And not just what's necessary for mobile, but what the opportunities and what you can do with mobile that you otherwise might not be doing. And I have a wish list of companies that I wanted to come present, and I managed to get them. So I'm pretty jazzed about that, and this afternoon was awesome. So I'm going to start off by introducing Michael Looney. Michael's his first name. Looney's just a nickname. But everybody calls him Looney. I've been having trouble remembering the rest of his name because of that. But Michael has started five startups. Ground Truth is one of them, and Ground Truth is this really interesting company in Seattle that's sort of measuring the web, or measuring mobile, in a way that nobody else is doing right now. And Michael's going to give maybe 7 minute little chat about what he's doing, and then we'll introduce the rest of the panelists. Welcome, Michael. All right, I'll hold the gear. All right, so thanks for inviting me down to Portland. As Jason said, I'm from Seattle. And my company's called Ground Truth. So what we do is measure the mobile internet. And the description of that we give is that this is everything that people do on phones that isn't voice. Right, so we do a lot of things with phones that isn't voice. In fact, voice is now starting to be the minority of things. So the first thing we started out was measuring, sorry, we'll start with me. So this is me.
Can you turn off the lights?
I started five startups. I started about 20 years ago in Seattle, a company called Nimble, which did software for the very first pen computers and smartphones and PDAs, just back in the days of the Nuke and the Tom Pilot and so forth. Did something else not mobile for a while, went back into mobile, was the head of app development at Informa. So before the iPhone, we actually had apps and games on phones. And so I worked on that for quite some time. Then I left Informa to start Media Systems, which is a mobile search and advertising company. Now it's doing some other analytics on mobile. And then at Medio, I had a problem that probably some of you had, which is I didn't know what was going on anymore. I knew what my company was doing. I knew that other companies were mobile, but I didn't know what they were doing. So I went and bought the mobile research that existed, found it inadequate, and had one of those moments that said, I'll just do it myself. And so I have, it's called Ground. And the last line is to say, we just merged with another company, so we're actually called Mobile Intelligence Solutions, as of a few weeks ago.
That's not
going to
work.
So I'd like to actually start out my talk saying, well, what is mobile? Right, so here we are at Mobile Portland, and a lot of you people work on apps. How many people work on apps? Right, how many people work in the mobile web space or mobile devices? Right, well, all this is mobile, so I always look at mobile in two ways. Mobile's the fifth medium. Right, before mobile, there were four media. There's TV, radio, print, the internet, which is different on PCs than mobile, so I guess those apart. And now phone. Which is off the right of the screen. So I asked that question. A little bit. And mobile's also been called the third screen. Right? So you got TV screens that people stare at, you got PC screens that they stare at all day long, and now there's more and more time being spent staring at mobile screens. Right? Both the same thing. And there's another way to look at mobile as well, which is what kind of devices? So clearly mobile phones are mobile, right? Everyone thinks of that. We count tablets as mobile, right? People in the PC space are saying, well, it's something like a PC, it's a little portable computer, whatever. Clearly, it's a mobile device that you carry from place to place. And the apps on tablets seem to be a lot like the apps on phones, in fact, some of them are both. So for us, that's mobile. And then there's e-readers, and then there's other things. There's netbooks, which are kind of dying off. A year or so ago, that was still in the and then there's fact, there are PCs now that are more mobile than not. So my PC, where my bag is, right, it's traveling around with me. I'm not in my office. I have a different use of that PC when I'm on the road than when in the office or at home. And we try and capture, you know, our goal is to capture everything in mobile, and that includes all of these different devices. I said, how do we do what we do? There's really three methodologies to measure any media. Right? Some of you guys heard this in an hour. Sorry. You can survey the populace. Right? You can either survey everybody or you can create your own little panel of people that you survey over and over again. That was the state of art of mobile measurement as of 18 months ago with Ground Truth. So there are companies like ComScoreNielsen, and then they have panels of 2,000, 10,000 people, and they ask them questions every month. And they'll publish those reports, and you can subscribe, and you can find out how many people have a phone and how many people use cameras on their phone. But when you try to slice it down to how many people went to Facebook yesterday or this week, and how much did they consume, and how did that compare against CNN, and how much did it compare against ESPN, and any of the birds, you can't do it on a survey. It's just impossible. The next one down is to look at a meter. So the way people measure PCs is to put spyware on a PC. And the people with that spyware know it's there, they've opted in.
So you can do the same in mobile, it's just really hard. And it's excessively hard because there's more than one platform. And it's excessively hard because some of those platforms don't want to have you on their iPhones do not like that. And trying to create a group of 100,000 or 200,000 or 300,000 people with meters just costs a large amount of money, a very long amount of time. But it's starting to happen, it's just excessively hard to do. But even harder than that is to get the actual data off the network. So that's what I started. So Ground Truth has sample data, has a sample of data from wireless carriers. We cover about, we call tens of millions of Americans. And we see what they do every single day in their browsing behaviors. Apps are slightly different, we'll talk about that in more time. So we take this data, we data mine it, we turn that into accurate reports, and that's the basis of our reports. And we do blend in some of the other pieces because we don't have data from every carrier, and we don't have data from every phone, so we need to fill in some of the gaps.
I think you're right. The carriers are giving you the data.
The carriers are sharing their data with us for this purpose.
And mobile carriers.
Mobile carriers. Wow. Giant carriers. We don't say which ones, but some of them include Verizon, AT&T. and lastly, before I stop here, one more thing. When you look at mobile measurement, is more often than not, when you see things in the news, you're going to see reports like this. So this is something that comes out of Millennium Media. It's a piece of marketing that looks like research. Right? It is something about their data, and it's indicative of where they spend their money. It's not indicative of the whole market. So they'll talk about how Android doubled, but they won't tell you that they just doubled the sales force on Android. This is where the state-of-the-art was, again, 18 months ago. You'd see AdMob reports, and you'd see some other reports. And it's starting to be cleaned out by seeing reports from Nielsen and Comscore around the world.
How much time they were spending, based on your results versus the category. And now we've added a new layer to that, which we call segmentation, which helps you identify who are the people that are the most valuable to you in your business. The two major features that we have just released are audience and age extrapolation. So we are able to tell you, based on the other apps that your users are using that have YSTK, and also through an algorithm, we're able to tell you who are your users, how old they are, where they come from, whether they're male or female. And then the second interesting tool that we've released is a tool that we call segmentation that allows you to have all the information that we provide you for your general population, but restricted to a segment of users. So you decide the segment that you want to choose to focus on. Date of acquisition is a segment that you can try and see. For example, you know, did the users that you acquired organically, you know, when you launch your game, are they better users of the ones that are signing up because their friends heard of them, of your app? So yeah, that's an interesting tool for segmentation. Another one is, for example, in-app purchasing. You want to look at the people that are in-app purchasing in your app. Who are they? Are they mostly male, female? Where do they live? What do they do in your app? So you can basically use all this information and tune your app for the best monetization and the best retention of your users. You can also target by country, language, heaviest use. And so I think this new release that we released last year, really last week, so really focused on, you know, who is your best user, the people that are social, the people that purchase in your game, the people that are the most active in your app, what do they look like, and how do we engage with them? And that's what we kind of provide with this new release of Florian Analytics.
Basically the mobile guru at WebTrends, director of mobile analytics, is that correct? And he has been working recently not only on WebTrends tools for analytics, mobile analytics, but has also been doing some work trying to standardize the ways in which we measure mobile so that as we look at things from platform to platform, there's some consistency in that regard. So please welcome Eric.
I'm Eric Brinson, director of mobile for WebTrends. My charter within WebTrends is not only to focus on how to give brands a good understanding of their customers' experience through their mobile channel, but also to extend that out to kind of our suite of products. So we focus not only on the understanding products, but also on the optimization side. So as your needs mature over time, we can help you deliver targeted messages through whatever properties you're managing for mobile, do multi-direct testing, A/B testing, and that whole array of things. The great thing about WebTrends, you know, we're not WebTrends in 1999, we're not just focused on web analytics anymore, we're really focused on digital analytics. So we see the category of mobile as something that's morphing into the larger umbrella of digital. Digital will encompass all this. So as we talked about before, and Lumi described all the great different channels and media live within the mobile media, we really see that as kind of IP connected. So we try to provide an umbrella of products and services that help you understand and manage kind of all of your investment within digital. So whether it's web, mobile, or social, providing insight and optimization in that space. So the great thing is I get to hit the road and talk to, you know, people like you, field your questions, and understand what, you know, what are your pain points, your needs, what do you need to understand with your global audience today, and take that home and build products that help answer those. So I'm looking forward to digging in during the panel. My pitch is really short. It's really, if you want to understand and optimize your mobile channel, give us a call. This afternoon, so I'm actually on vacation this week. I could not free myself up at 3 o'clock or 3:30 for the demo. I'm really sorry about that. But please reach out to me. And next week, we get a WebEx set up. And anybody that's interested, I'll step through the product demo and take it, you know, as long as we want through the Q&A. So a couple ways to find me. Give me your card, ask for my card, find me on Twitter at Ricksone, so R-I-C-K-S-O-N-E. or find us on WebTrends Mobile on Facebook.
Because the native experience is
probably for gaming and for apps in general, as somewhat of a better user experience. And also because, to be completely honest, it's really difficult to understand what's going on between the native app and the mobile browser together. As I was mentioning during my talk before, it's really difficult to understand where things are coming from in the app. Because basically, the minute you enter the App Store, all the cookies, all the information that you had before are basically blocked. And similarly, when you exit the app, it's pretty hard to tell what goes on after. So we really took the decision to build an SDK that really maximizes the information that you get about what your users are doing in your app. So we don't really apply any of the language that comes from regular web analytics. For us, a page view doesn't really mean anything. The key metrics for us in terms of native analytics are daily active users, how many people come back to your game, because you're looking at a device where people are on their device all the time and come back really regularly. You think in terms of sessions, and most importantly, you think in terms of events, meaning what events are people accomplishing in your game. And I think that's something that's really, really different from the regular web analytics.
Can I respond?
Yeah.
So I definitely agree that app analytics require kind of a different metaphor. So we do that with our app analytics too. So I think we've adopted what we see as the broader market call those types of actions or events, or the nomenclature for apps is different. Now, the nomenclature for apps is different. It doesn't matter if it's mobile or desktop, it's different. So it's measuring an application compared to different things. I'm a product manager, I care about adoption, right? So technically meet users, so we can measure that as well. We actually talk about screen views of some pages. So why a screen view is important, if it all ties back to your monetization strategy. So are you selling products through your application? Are you driving people to find store location? Are you selling ads? So even though uptake on ad sales is still relatively low in mobile compared to other digital channels, it's still there. So what we provide is the opportunity to have some type of valuable impression. So we call this screen views, the venue in which some transaction takes place. And then tying back to the events or behaviors that we care about, that I like to think about it as like, they either need to represent some value to the business in terms of revenue opportunity or cost savings. And that's ultimately what you're judging the success or failure against your app strategy. Unless you're an app entrepreneur that's selling your application to more clients.
Yeah, one quick thought. One thing that is common between apps and web is sessions. And so one of the key metrics, in addition to unique size, audience size, is number of sessions. Sessions per user, time of sessions, time per user, and so forth. And so that's the three metrics that both apps and web have in common. We'll see what else comes later.
So one of the assertions that Tommy Ahonen makes. Tommy Ahonen is a former Nokia blogger, a former Nokia technical director, talks a lot about mobile. He talks about mobile being the most accurate medium for measurement. And so I'm curious how. So we've talked a little bit about the differences and the challenges related between mobile versus PC, but I'm curious about the opportunities related to getting more accuracy, whether it's location or whether it's, Luna, you were talking about carrier data. I mean, it seems like there's an opportunity related to mobile that you don't have in the other space. Like, where do you see, like, are we just at the beginning of that, or are there more opportunities that we have because we explore it?
Yeah, so if you remember the dream of the digital space in the late 90s was going to be one-to-one marketing. Because all of a sudden we had a media where you could measure the person on the other side. And then in reality we found out that it's not a person on the other side, it's a household. So it was no better, right? More or less, it's no better than TV, no better than print. You can measure the household, but not the person. Well,
sorry,
it's okay. Now we have the ability to have phone number, the person attached to the device. And it still seems, more and more, that this device hangs around with one person. It sits in one person's pocket. And it's really not shared that often. And so finally we have a media where we can measure what one person did without worrying about whether or not that really was one person or whether it really was one household and so forth. And so in that one aspect, mobile should be more accurate. Now, we have tons of challenges around measuring everything in mobile. But should we get all those challenges right, we should have more accurate.
Okay. So the fact that people buy new phones every 18 to 24 months, and I mean, how many people in this room have more than one device? Yeah, that's another problem. So, I mean, in our household, we have two iPads, a bunch of phones, and iPods, and things like that. I think one of the big challenges is, how do you identify somebody in a way that's acceptable to consumers that works across commercial channels? I think this is a big problem in front of us, which is, what's the REI membership number for, not only for every brand, but for kind of, this whole online network. So that's the big challenge, I think, that needs to be solved out there in a way that we, as people, all feel comfortable with identifying themselves. Today, when dealing with app analytics, it's just a joy to do this because we have things like UDID to latch on to identify kind of the unique identifier. We've got it for a few more weeks. The great thing is, in my world, it's a little less important because you can just ask for an ID and we'll send you one in the store if your system has a device and you own it.
And so actually, as long as we brought up the UDID one, for those who don't know, last week, last week people started noticing the fact that the terms of service has changed so that UDIDs are no longer allowed, or they're deprecated, I guess I should say. And so that's going to cause some issues. And then, I guess, sort of talk about that in general, if that applies and what you're doing about it, and then just more generally, like, how do we balance the sort of marketing desire for, Joe is looking at this app or this website on this street corner while, like, picking his nose with, somebody's need for privacy.
Yeah, absolutely. So the needs from a service like mine versus an ad network are completely different. So the biggest impact of this change would be the ad networks. Their goal is to tie our behavior over multiple different properties to target us with ads that are more relevant to us. Okay, so when they don't have the UDID anymore, they can't connect the dots over multiple properties. In the web trends world, we serve usually single brands or single publishers, and they own all the data. So we're not having to connect those dots across multiple properties. An ID that's issued from one property versus that over time, it's really not a big deal for us. It's really I see it more as a challenge for the ad networks. What was the second half of your question?
Just generally, how do you, as a corporation, try to strike a balance between, the need to identify people with sort of privacy?
Yeah, I think it's a litmus test of what's creepy and what's not. So it really comes back to PII. So UDID can be seen as private, as identifiable information, but ultimately we don't hold any of the information that allow you to identify something. Carriers do a lot of times, but we're not. To us, it's been an anonymous identifier. Our method has been to take that ID, we'll hash it into something that's not understandable to anybody, and use that as a unique method for tracking somebody. It's not going to be a big change for us. I think the key thing for brands that are out there wanting to identify something publicly, ask their permission, right? So UDID part aside, but if you're actually tying something back to some kind of registration ID or some type of person identifiable information, cover your cost and policy. Tell your customers how you're going to use their data, ask for their consent, and then you're fine. If there's a value transaction, giving you that information, if you're giving them valuable content, personalizing an experience that's useful to them, they're going to keep that opt-in relationship with you. It's when, most of us are just, going about our days browsing the web, using apps, and don't know how you're using the information, that's pissing us off, it concerns us, we don't know how it's going to be used, or sold, or shared. So, I guess one little tip is, keep that, just like you learned how to do a decade ago with websites, update your compact privacy policy to a language that people understand how you're using their data, and that'll help you avoid some of those class action lawsuits that we saw hit Google and Apple. So, and the last thing, Angry Birds actually is a really good example.
In America, people are concerned about their privacy and rights, but in Europe, there are all manner of laws about having
it's a good question. And usually it's...
repeat the question.
Yes, the question was, what are we doing about individual, I guess, let's say global laws around individual privacy? And it's usually a German member of the audience that asks that question. So seriously, it's a hard question. And what that means is that there usually have to be some rules to get applied that say eliminate this data. Google just released some capabilities recently where they'll lose like the last, four, six digits of an IP address, because in Germany, they consider IP as a bit of PII. So the key thing, I think, is like, that's a great use of geo-targeting to say, you know, what do we need to do to build in rules around what data we can capture? Because we shouldn't just rush to the low common denominator. We should rush to what's the bare minimum in this. So, you know, it does make sense if you're serving, especially in Germany, really, in the EU, it's based on privacy and security. And so it's, you know, if you can identify the German audience, it basically eliminates a certain set of information. Where in the United States, we have a lot of legislation in the process that may change the rules very soon. So it's probably a safe place to be a little more conservative right now.
So I
want to
wait just a second. I just want to ask Woody, so are the carriers giving you, like they're giving you, you know, millions of logs with all of our personal information, right? Like, how's that working?
No, we, just to clarify, we get no personal information whatsoever on the carriers. Everything we get is anonymous. And we were somewhat surprised by Apple's move with the UDIDs. We don't use UDIDs, so it didn't affect us whatsoever.
And Isabel, so Flurry, has had some privacy stuff in the past, and the UDIDs can definitely impact you.
Yes, well, the first thing, I guess reacting to Eric's comment, it is going to, so just as a reminder, Flurry Analytics is free. The way we monetize our business is through advertising, so we can also talk a little bit about the advertising. I think it is also going to impact developers in general. We talked about this a little bit during the afternoon session. On the gaming side, for example, a lot of developers use the UDIT to connect to the same user across several devices to store game sessions, game information, high scores, all that kind of information. So it is going to affect other just also developers as well as the ad networks. On the ad network side, it is going to affect a small part of our ad network offering. But I think that I really agree with what you said, Eric, that there's definitely it's a sensitive space right now. I think Apple's move was a bit sudden, but went in the direction that they really are trying to distance themselves from all these privacy policies. I agree with Eric also, we really encourage our developers to include the use of third-party services in their privacy policy, their terms of service. So basically, if you use our analytics or someone else's analytics, it's not very complicated to update your terms of service to let your users know that they can opt out if they want to. So,
at that point, you guys encourage people not to use the default analytics from people like Apple.
I can only speak to the EULA, but I think in terms of your actual privacy policy, that's in addition to the EULA. So it's really important to have a public-facing statement that is more accessible, more easy to understand. So again, I am not giving legal advice here. This might counsel kick my ass if I said that. But basically, the key thing is that it is understandable. So there's a lot of good examples out there. Most in-your-face that I've seen was AccuWeather. And like right after the class action lawsuits were filed against them, I think it was Apple at that time. I could be wrong. But it very quickly turned around. The next app update that I got had this, you must accept this new term, basically their new EULA, but then had a link to the privacy policy from there.
So just going back also to the UDAP, so I also agree with Eric. I think it's important to think in terms of PII as well as the UDAP. Right now, the UDID, I mean, though there's debate about it, but I think like the UDID doesn't really contain the PII. I don't know about the other advertising network, personal identifiable information. I'm not really sure about the policies of the other ad networks. I can tell you what we do. We don't track any PII at all. We don't track your email address, your social security number, your address, your credit card. We don't track any of that. We are going to be affected by the end of the UDIDs. On Android, there is no UDID, and the advertising business still works. So I think most of the advertising networks are going to find new ways of attaching identifiers to users by creating their own. So it's just going to be less of a convenient standard. It's just before everyone universally used the UDID, but it is doable.
The question is directed towards Looney. In my opinion, the carrier information is the holy grail to mobile analytics. And to be able to access that information is very, very critical. How do you get this information? Is it public or is it a relationship that you have with the carrier? What is that?
Give it to anyone who wants.
I'm sorry.
Anybody you want. What I realized when I was sitting at my previous company was that I knew this data existed and sat around thinking if only I had a copy of it, I would have the answer you were seeking. I'd have the answer all of us were seeking, which is what are people doing mobile? And I found a way, which is proprietary and we don't share, on how to approach a carrier and get them to share this data.
So you have the carrier's permission for this data, or you don't?
Yes, we have relationships with multiple US carriers of all shapes and sizes, and in fact, we have our hardware sitting in their networks to analyze their data.
Thank you.
And we do this on a daily basis.
Okay. So offline, this is mobile up here, and I use Flurry in my app. But offline the interest, right? So right now my iOS app, we're all data. They can download the one device without actually being online. What's the general thinking on how many devices you ever online, you're sort of thinking about your ability to handle this, well, how many does this really sit offline people? What's the general thinking?
So the question was, how do you, I'll just summarize, I believe, how do you handle offline usage of apps? So people are, playing the app, they're offline, maybe they don't go online for, a couple weeks. How do you handle offline access to
Or maybe I'll talk to my CEO and say, hey, these are the number of accounts, which will rate for my own stuff. I get stuff directly if I'm personal online. But I want to talk and say, well, if this is like 80% or 90% or 70%.
Do you lose data because of offline usage?
So in the Flurry SDK, you don't actually. The Flurry SDK stores all the data that happens offline and then reports it as soon as your user, the app goes back online, and then your storefront is updated with all the data that happened while you were offline.
And that's what sends sexual.
Yes. So on apps, it's not really an issue because we store all the data that happens, when you're playing offline And I think that's if you're doing mobile native analytics, that's really important because on the touch, as you were saying, on the, like, lots of games, a lot of gaming happens offline. So for us, at least we store it, and it's important to do it because otherwise you're missing out on a huge part of user experience.
We do it too. So that was one of the first features as we invested in building out a mobile solution. That was the biggest requirement, so we handled the offline mode. Also, it allows us to kind of collect all the data on the side and send it off at the right time. So not letting the apps offline, but maybe, and this is kind of those things that you can set up. If you have 15% battery power left, you might not want to introduce the risk that your analytics will be using juice and you want to save it for your app. So there's other business rules that just offline that are for kind of queuing and caching data.
And so how's that done? Is it connected core data on iOS or iOS or are you actually persisting it on to?
Yeah, it's kept in a local data store. So I believe iOS it's a SQLite database, is that right? I don't know. I'm just a product guy, not that technical. Oh. But it's we store it locally on the device and the data store is accessible to the application. It's a core function of our SDKs. So we use, just to back up a few questions back, WebTrends provides SDKs for the major application platforms. We also have an API that you can write to. The advantage of using SDKs, we built in all the logic that does the queuing and caching and sending to our service. Where if you do the API route, especially you mentioned before, knowing already outside of using Flurry, that to me, I hear he's got some server-side measurement that he's using. The downside of that is you don't necessarily get every action when it's in offline mode. So that's
right. Do you guys have any sense, or have you published any data about the percentage of app usage that's online versus offline?
Unfortunately, our relationship with our clients and data ownership doesn't let us do that, but there's some awesome insight that's offered by a company called Flurry and Ground Truth. On the publishing side, it's all in there.
Yeah, well, you guys bring up a really good point. There's one hole in the app measurements from not just WebTrends and Flurry and everybody else, in that they'll cache the data, but then the app has to run again in order for it to upload. And so there's one measurement that's done in the PC space that we ask what's the differences between PC and mobile. That's called bounce rate, right? So in the PC space, you count up how many sites had one page visit and nothing else, because that kind of indicates a failed experience. And there's no way in the app measurement tools to do that. You can't tell unless they were online and unless the data got sent before the app got closed, whether there was a bounce, whether someone tried the game, didn't like it, never ran it again. And when we get out our app measurement reports, our goal is to have that measurement, to also have that code.
So bounce rate is absolutely possible, except for people that never go online. Okay, so the use case is that you download an application and you launch it in offline mode and never launch it online. So our process is different than some analytics providers, is that we get rid of the data when we can. So we don't hold it to any session, we just unload it when the stars align. So we tend to see that. So one, offline mode is only important to you if your app supports it. So a lot of apps require some constant HTTP connection to work. Even a lot of games require that. I'm not sure if it's just for the purpose of analytics, but that's the key, is that you can actually get rid of saving it. It's definitely it's got it, yeah. Okay, so the key thing is actually bounce rate is a pretty valid measure. The hole in that is for offline, and then, sorry, I think it's an edge case.
So over here, and then over there.
So I think of, how many people in here are Android or iOS independent developers? Okay, so my question is, I think of Flurry as free, and WebTrends as maybe a more substantial corporate offering. So as an independent developer, how do I choose among analytics platforms? That's part A. Part B is how can you talk about the different user types you serve with the interface you present? So, do you present to marketers, analytics professionals, success rate of their app.
That was correct for me. Okay, so let's see. Let's start with the first question, which was free versus paid. I think that I'm happy to have a more one-to-one conversation where I don't have to play a bunch of competitive FUD against one of my fellow panel members. So I think the way that I differentiate is we do serve slightly different markets. So we live in an ecosystem where free is very important. I think that you'll run into, as your needs in terms of depth of data and data mature, I think you'll find that WebTrends provides some flexibility and tailorability that you won't find in a free solution. So, and I'm happy to go in. And anybody who wants to like explore that in depth, I'm happy to kind of go into that. So it's really kind of depth of understanding and usage of the data that you have. So in terms of the other one, what are the personas that we target? So we target primarily marketing and product professionals. Usually for brands that span between the mid-market to the enterprise class company. So we are trying to serve a different market. I think that, and I don't speak for Flurry, but I think that there's a great need to get out into tens of thousands of applications to fuel a number of different products from the data. And advantages for going that route. And for us, it's really around, we're not just an app analytics company, we're a digital marketing analytics company. So if you have a Facebook page or a Facebook app, you want to understand how your audience is engaging with it, come talk to us. We can provide that side by side with integrating data from your SMS provider, pulling your data potentially from Flurry or GroundTruth, integrating that into your service, in line with your websites, your blogs, your mobile apps, this. Again, we're focused a little bit more on the product owner, and again, I think it's the depth that is valuable for a developer, but we're not selling products that are targeted at the developer. Now, you're also one of our most important stakeholders, so making sure that my SDKs are highly performant and are efficient, and don't really screw with your app's performance or interfere with functionality is critical. So, you're very important for us to consider. We provide some analytics for you, but I think it's really the broader product and market organization that we serve.
So I know this question was directed to WebTrends, but I guess, Lee, earlier you mentioned sort of like who your target customers are and like who you're dealing with right now. I think that might be helpful in case, you know, like people are trying to understand like, oh, can we go again, like the crazy carrier data.
Yeah, so just as, so everyone understands the difference between what my company measures and what these two guys measure. I try and, my company tries to measure the whole market. At least the top many thousands of apps, the top tens of thousands of websites, not your one app. Right? So people come to my company asking, how am I doing and how are my three competitors doing? And then name the three competitors. And that's all I really care about. Right? Despite the fact I'm measuring today 20,000 websites, they only care about four. Right? It's just a different core for every customer. And then someone asked a few hours ago, well, how expensive is it? And the only answer I gave was it's expensive. Unlike PC, there is no quantcast yet in mobile. There's no even in mobile. There's no bottom end of the market. So there's no one who's publishing 100 author or less per month for in the mobile web. And so we simply started at the top. We're working our way down. And we have plans at coming up with that product. It's $100 a month. We have to get back in. We're still working at the
I think for us, so just so that everyone understands the story, it's not always very clear. We track 50,000 apps so far, so we have to create about 98% of smartphones. And then out of those, 100,000 apps, 50,000 developers. Out of those 50,000 developers, about 1,000 are part of our ad network. And the way we monetize our analytics is by targeting all our ads based on the data that we collect through analytics. So if you just want to use the analytics and a very, very large number of our partners want to do that, Flurry Analytics will always be free. It'll never be paid. I think we compare pretty well to paid services. think before the launch of Analytics 3.0, we had fallen a little bit behind in terms of cohort creation, segment creation, and everything. I think with the new release, we're pretty much, I think, you know, in a really good position. And I think that Flurry was, you know, Flurry's really always a tool built by developers for developers. And I think it always is, it was born with the idea that if you want to build a successful app for a successful game, you need analytics. And if it's your first app or your first game, there's no way you're going to have the resources internally to build your own analytics that will provide as much depth and information as what we provide. So if you're an independent, you know, developer, I would really, I think Flurry is a good option for you. I think as Eric mentioned, where our strategies differ is that we are entirely focused on native apps, and, you know, help you, you know, with the analytics for your iOS and Android apps. We don't really have any analytics outside of the platform. So if you're looking to build, you know, a digital strategy across all your brands, and you're looking for kind of like the bigger picture, you know, getting a bit of perspective on your digital strategy across, you know, mobile, the mobile internet, mobile browsing, websites, native apps, then I think indeed you want to get something that's a bit more cross-platform than we are. And regarding just like the, sorry, regarding the audience of Flurry Analytics, I think it's a little bit of everyone, to be honest, because I think Flurry was really created in the idea, like, to cater to the analytics need of the startup, basically. So you have all your technical information. We talked about that during this small session earlier. The crash logs, you know, the user paths, the events, you know, percentage of people that, you know, are upgrading to the new versions. All that are really tools that are really interesting for developers, I think. And then we also have, especially with the new segmentation, tools that are really, you know, just good to maximize the monetization of your games if you're doing games. You know, through analyzing which in-app purchases and who are purchasing, who's being social in your game, that's really more of a marketing tool. But I mean, if you're a two-person startup and an independent developer, chances are you're going to be the developer, the marketing person, you know, the business person, you're going to be everyone.
Okay. This is
going
to be back.
Trying to think of a situation where these types of analytics should be combined a lot of these analytics would be combined in real time and be able to use by the application in larger groups in real time. I was wondering if that was ever going to be a product that people saw use for, in that the application itself could not only use its own analytics, but feed off the analytics of others and feed that into the application and somehow be useful, have an interactive conversation with an analytical API so that it could customize the application in real time. I could think of location apps or whatnot, so it knows the demographic of other uses of that application in different areas. And if that was ever something that somebody thought about, or...
So is it, if I'm understanding it correctly, it's like the analytics engines have, and Flurry, or Isabel, right? Isabel was talking earlier about Flurry having a decent amount of demographic information, you know, that they can provide via the analytics reports, but is it possible to actually query that information in real time and make decisions about how the app would be paid, or is that something that's, is that sort of...
Right, exactly.
Okay.
Or was it, so in a couple of ways to think about it, you've got the concept of content targeting, personalization, and optimization. So optimization being things like presenting certain content segments to people. Is that kind of in line with your question?
Customization based on the analytics that you're having.
Yes.
Having a two-way conversation rather than...
More demographic information than, say, the app developer does, and it would be great to be able to, instead of getting that at like the end of the week, every report, to be able to actually say, oh, this person is blah, you know, based on demographics, should I be able to make something based on that?
Yeah, so I think that, and I'm sure it's more interesting things to say than I do, but there's a couple different uses. So one, content personalization, being able to look at what is popular content across the network of my application users or any other channel, and then be able to make kind of promotional decisions in terms of dynamic content for them. So that's agnostic of the person viewing the content and saying that, you know, people find this interesting, so you might want to do it. The next step is to be able to identify segments that provide the same type of understanding. So whether or not you're presenting an offer or content or media that's interesting to like people. So it may be a behavioral segment. Some people that abandoned some process, that engaged in some other activity, maybe demographic, maybe geographic, and then being able to present them back with specialized content. We're not seeing huge demand for that in the marketplace. We have technologies and tools that are focused on providing that for traditional web or fixed web, as we call it. But we've got tools, we don't see a big demand in the marketplace yet. Now, I think 2012 will be a shift in that. We're seeing some of our early adopting customers starting to ask for it now, and starting to do things like multivariate testing, A/B testing through mobile experiences. That's an early indicator of a willingness to give up some of the art that we as marketers or merchandisers or content managers have, and let some intelligent system provide that back.
It just always seems like it's after the fact, you know, like I gather all this data, then I make this reaction later on as I'm processing it later on in the application. Well, I change the application.
What I'm hearing in your question is the real-time feedback for one of these solutions. In the traditional web, in the PCs, there's a different player that plays that role. So there's WebTrends and Omniture and CoreMetrics that are analytics, but then there are companies like BlueKai and a pile of other companies that will tell you something about this cookie that showed up on your site. They'll be, I think there's profiles, right? So they'll give you something about this particular customer that you want to know. If there's anything specific to your site, you want to, you generally, again, on the traditional web, you'll have the person log in for your account, and you'll have your own profile. But in terms of third-party pieces, it's typically played by a different role, and there are a few of those just starting to roll, but except for Flurry, it's an edge there for the ad networks, but they're just starting to mobile to have these other players come in and put their records in. And Urban Airship counts on those. So Urban Airship has something that, I don't remember the details, has to do with messaging and customers are showing.
As Lee said, the only area right now where I see this really implemented is the connection between analytics and mobile advertising. And we're not the only ones that, you know, have kind of found out about that interesting connection. There's other companies, Taptoy partnered with Absolar at some point to provide, you know, advertising that was targeted on the analytics. So I've heard of that a little bit. For example, you will get different ads depending on who you are. We try to target those as to you. So I think it's definitely going to happen mobile through advertising. An interesting way that I think it's going to happen and that will actually really be effective is the actual, maybe not the content of the game, but at least the way the game is presented being modified depending on who you are, that being tracked by analytics. And here I'm going to give a little shout out to one of our competitors, Absolor, who's doing something that's really cool, that is basically they are ranking in-app purchases that are being presented differently depending on who you are and the type of analytical information that they have. And I think that's really where the future of that is really going, is the ability to present to your user, like a pink pony when you're a female, between the age of 13 and 18, and on the other hand, a Ferrari when you're a male. That becomes really interesting because you're actually creating a customized game that's, evolving with your user. So that's really, so far, that's the only real kind of, interesting use that I've seen, but I'm sure there will be, as I said, next year, some interesting
developments.
All right, so three more questions. So,
So, you have a web experience on a phone, and you have an app experience on a phone. And between the three of you, I think you're probably getting some insights on what are the things that engage people with websites, what are the things that engage people with apps, and what will someone in an app look like?
I'll try to make my response kind of brief on this one. I think it's a great question. I think the key thing for mobile web, block and tackle, right? So if you're making an investment decision on, so if you're a brand, getting yourself out there, not necessarily the app developer kind of use cases, that's definitely, there's a lot of money to do on the outside. But if you're a brand trying to get yourself out in mobile, I think mobile web is a great place to start. It's the low common denominator that you need to be there in order to take part and effectively impact things like SMS, web call to action, to engage in things like QR codes. You have to have a mobile optimized site. My favorite example of a fail in mobile app advertising was Coca-Cola was the sole sponsor at Hallmark's ultimate gift that last winter. And they basically took people there. It was an iPhone-only application. They pushed people to their My Coke Rewards site. And big fail was, oh shit. Right. So that's a big example, and it's fun to post with our clients with the teasing a lot. But you have to start off with mobile web. If you want to engage in multiple mobile tactics, that's the place to be, especially if you're in retail. If you're in B2B, it's like you think about is it your product you're trying to take mobile, or is it your market? The next side is on the app side. Sort of lose the question. So yeah, so I'll pass it off to my man.
Okay, well, if you want to play the odds, then unfortunately they don't line up because on the mobile web you gotta do something social. And on mobile apps you gotta do something gaming. Right? So depending on what your company is doing, you're either playing in those odds or you're not. Right? The one thing that they both have in common is small bits of time. Right? And this is again one big difference between mobile and PCs is session time that people spend on a mobile phone doing anything is really short. Right? They'll come in and they'll check their Facebook status and one thing and then they'll get out. And they'll come back and do it again. And I've seen a lot of different mobile websites that have that pattern where people will come and check and check and check over and over multiple times per day, but they won't stay more than a minute. Right? It's very hard to get people sticking on a phone when they have other things to do. I haven't seen all the stats in apps, but what I have seen is
okay. Really quick, here's one on that. Back. Okay, so yeah, but we still need to consider so tablets part of the definition of mobile. And one of the things, so Telegraph UK is one of our clients. Last year, they launched a free version of their subscription service to kind of learn about their audience and have more coming tools out there. And they saw that so they had an average of 8 minutes online through traditional PC, and they had 10.5 minutes on average through iPad. So much longer engagement, much higher likelihood of somebody clicking on an ad. Now maybe that was back in the era when none of us, we all thought that iAds were mythical creatures because there were many of them out there who were probably clicking on this. But much higher engagement, much greater depth of purchase at a different time of day. So tablet is not just a it's not just a lean back device. We're seeing that people are using it as an alternate source to PC, and it's a different period of time. So they're able to actually reach a different or the same audience at a different time of day. So before work, after work, weekends. So it's huge on the tablet side.
Same, almost complicated.
I agree with everything that's been said. I think on the app side, you said you have to be gaming. I actually don't think you have to be gaming. I think what you, the problem with the app, the native app environment, is that it's all about attention. And I think it's been kind of proven also in the new algorithm by Apple. It's, they're not focusing so much now on downloads. They're focusing now on how much people use your app on a daily basis. And I think that's true also with, you know, the Android algorithm now. And if you look at, for example, the apps that are actually making money, the top grossing apps, most of them are free, but they're always in the top rows. You have people that just come back every day, three times a day. So I think when you're thinking in terms of strategies, you need to think, is what I'm creating something that my users are going to want to come back, let's say an average of once, but probably more like twice a day. So I think for news, for example, mobile apps are really relevant. And I agree, I totally understand and think it's totally plausible that people are spending more time on apps than they were on their desktop. I think for other brands, I've seen lots of brands designing experiences that are not really supposed to be, you know, something you go back to every day. And in that case, maybe mobile web is just more adapted. And I don't mean that in a kind of mobile web is not as good, that's not the case. It's just that there's no point having an app that you're gonna have people install once and then never go back to. It's just so much development and you're just gonna be lost in the 100,000 apps that are
So I fall into the evening and weekend independence app category. And I've got an app which is very well received. It's fairly niche though. It's, you know, kid video. And what we've found is, you know, so it has no advertising, no in-app, and right now it's in-app. No viral, no advertising. And it's paid app. We're not doing, you know, in-app purchase. And what we found is, essentially, we can't advertise because the cost of acquisition is more than our subscriptions. Do you see anything changing in the overall sort of mobile advertising space that, you know, kind of changes the dynamics for smaller, more niche and more, you know, long-tail sort of things like that, that could change that dynamic for smaller people?
So, Alright, so the question is, so small organizations, particularly that the piece we're working on, that the cost for acquisition of a paid user of the application via advertising is more expensive than what they actually get for selling the app. And so how do they, you know, like, is there anything that might change in that dynamic, anything that the panel sees that might help out people who are, you know, small shops trying to advertise their apps so they can sell them?
So I think mobile advertising right now is very good in some ways and very bad in others. I think the mobile advertising world has been also changed a lot since Apple banned incentivized installs. Basically, what incentivized installs was providing was cheap acquisition for you know, advertisers that wanted to promote their app, and on the other side, really good monetization revenue for publishers. I think there are lots of companies that have, and so not making it back. So right now what we have is most of the advertising system is either CPI based, meaning you pay for an install, or CPM based, you pay for banners. Flurry and, for example, Tapjoy are in the CPI basis, meaning advertisers only pay for installs. Right now the bid for an install is on for a free app is crazy. It's because there's a lot of advertising demand. There's no inventory. The there's less inventory. So by the way, if you want to become a publisher, now is the time. So there's less inventory. And so why are these companies paying, you know, $1.50 per user or something like that, $1 per user, for a free app? The reason is for a free app, there's actually, these companies are making basically a calculation that it's worth paying $1.50 for a user because, well, maybe only one of them will actually turn out to be a real user, but when they turn out to be a real user, they're spending a lot of money. And they'll spend probably much more money than what your user, what your app is worth right now. How much did you charge for your app?
$3.99.
Yeah. Flurry just released a post two weeks ago that the average transaction for the top 15 grossing games is $11. So I mean, that means that the average user spends $11, and then we have about, I think it's 7 to 8% of people that spend $40 or more per transaction. So the problem is this advertising or this ecosystem is restricted to basically free social gaming. It's the CrowdStars, the TinyZoos, the Zyngas, and they are the only ones that make the mobile advertising work as it is right now. Right now, there's no model for, I think, the paid app. Just because right now, mobile gaming and what really makes money is getting people addicted to a game and then kind of, you know, getting them to buy props, buy clothes for their top row, buy whatever.
Yeah, and one nice thing of doing mobile now, right, mobile fifth media, is to be able to look back at the fourth media and say, well, what worked there, and what are we missing? And one thing we're missing is truly targeted ads. We kind of have a little bit of that going, but we don't have great detail yet. So the problem that you're really seeing is you can't buy CPM ads targeted to the audience you want. You can either buy CPI ads for apparently outrageous prices, or run a market that just costs too much in aggregate. And so at some point, we'll solve this problem and we'll have targeted ads. But it'll be a while.
I know, I totally agree with that. And I think it's really interesting because you look today, Flurry also released a blog post, I think, a month ago, saying that time spent on mobile apps now has surpassed time spent on the web. Yet, when you look at advertisers, you look at all the really big advertising companies, all these companies that are spending insane amounts of money on TV and everything, they're not that much on mobile advertising. You don't really see them that much on iAd and mobile. What you see are ads for other apps, and it's hard to build an ecosystem out of the app install model. And I think the reason is exactly that, is that Madison Avenue doesn't want to blindly buy, you know, first they don't have apps, most of them, and secondly they don't want to buy like massive, you know, campaigns for people that they don't really know who they are. And so I think that's where, you know, the future of mobile advertising, and I think that's why the ban on incentivized installs is a good thing, because it's going to bring back, you know, it's going to make the industry go forward, is people paying more, but for really targeted audiences, meaning people that are in your app, you know, will know how much they're worth, will know what they do, and advertisers are all going to be willing to spend money on these targets, these segments, because they know that they're exactly the segments that they want and that they need in their app.
Yeah, I've seen interesting stats on this that show total amount of time spent per million. And I think it was 2010 figures, it was showing mobile that it's somewhere between 12 and 15% of all time spent. And now people are doing two things at once, but I'm just called 12% of time spent in front of the phone, and total spend in advertising at mobile was less than 1%. It's all U.S. numbers, right? Most of it's spent on TV. So this money's going to slosh over to mobile, right, in the next 5 years. We're going to be sitting in a much bigger crowd in the next 5 years.
Yeah, cool. So two words for you, guerrilla marketing. All right, so don't waste your money on mobile advertising. Go out and look for other promotional vehicles. The cheapest one available to you probably is social media. Okay, so even though your functionality doesn't exist in app for doing that, it's looking at what other promotional vehicles to really get people to discover your application, which is one of the biggest issues. But on a PC, talk to your friends, go to Facebook, you know, handbills, and I really think that grassroots promotion at this level is really important. get a sponsored byline somewhere. Have a point of view that's about the space that you're serving, and go pitch it to some local like article publisher. If you said it was in children's videos,
yeah.
All right, so go talk to Baby Depot and really pitch them on the idea. Read Write Web has a really cool conference, Unconference down the Bay. It was like, I think I went to it in May of 2010. They have roundtables where you're going there and doing 30-second demos. You have a pitch and get a VC to jump on to when you're doing it. But really, I think it's like, flip to Facebook. It's your community that drives some investment. And you start building some revenue that allow you to fund other online advertising. And then eventually, mobile advertising will become more important.
Okay, so Ron has the last question.
Okay, I have a question. One transitionary question. Transitionary question is, what, if any, advocacy are you expressing to Apple to provide install source information? So we don't know, as the question is, we don't know where apps are coming, where installs are coming from. Are you reaching out to Apple to try to get that change in the platform? The second one is different. I felt like a bigger indie developer before, but for product managers, hybrid applications allow an enormous amount of flexibility in maintaining applications. How well would you grade your solution as a platform today in servicing hybrid apps, native and HTML, like the iOS retail applications?
You're awesome.
I'll start with the second question regarding HTML5. I would have to be completely honest, we don't like service any of that.
You guys don't have to plug that at all?
I would say it's very easy to slap a listener on the HTML5 and give it a bit of a and you get into a group of to get the HTML5.
So I think there's definitely, and this is definitely one of the areas in which my competitors' companies are probably way more efficient than we are. So I know we're definitely thinking about it. The thing with HTML5 is I think everyone's been hearing about it for about like 2 or 3 years now. 6 years. I feel like we've been talking about it a lot. I think for a lot of our clients, I'm not sure it really makes sense. You have to make sure. I think we're talking about it. I'm not really sure when it's going to happen.
Reaching out to Apple regarding pass-through install data, source data for installs.
I don't think we're really in a position where we ask Apple to. We have a really good relationship with them, but I think everyone that's worked with Apple, whether it's on the developer side or the third-party side, knows that they're, one, a very supportive company. Two, they don't really, I mean, I remember working at GameHub, for example, they would never tell us when we were going to be promoted. They would randomly promote you, and they never really made you feel like you were in a business relationship with them. It was more like they were helping you out. So I don't think we're really in a position to ask that we've sometimes communicated changes that would be nice for us just to make the system work. I don't really know if they
No, we don't tell Apple anything, they don't tell us anything. They are the new carriers. But these phones, these iOS devices, when they go out to the App Store over a carrier network, make a request we can see. Cool.
We're going to talk. So I've been calling Steve for a while, and you guys are for my calls, but I'm really eager to do that. I don't think it's going to be any of us on the better side that actually influence that. It's going to be the major advertisers that do that. So it's, you know, call your congressman, call their lobbyists, to call the executives at Coca-Cola and Procter & Gamble, and, you know,
you know, Kimberly Clark, because they're the ones that are spending a ton of money with Apple. They're the ones that are going to demand that. So, yeah, so if we can get that from Android, you know, Google is great, nice and open, and they see it connected to spending money in search, so I guess they like that idea, so they want it measurable. So it's doable. We know that it's not allowed by Apple today, and you know, we use a product measure. We really want to provide that to my server. So the other question, can you refresh my memory?
The hybrid.
Hybrid. Wow, it's there's a ton of different hybrid use cases. So one that we're running into more and more are app publishers that started off fully native that have figured out that trying to replicate payment services through native components is a real headache. And so they're turning very quickly to mobile web that can use the same backend systems that their online transaction systems can use. So that's the easiest use case, which is 95% of the stuff happens in the native app. And then there are a few business critical functions that happen for mobile web. So the key there is that we're able to take all the information that we collect and transfer that across a different mode. And the challenge is in mobile web, you can't get the same rich data that you can get about a device that you can through a native application. So we need to build in some logic, usually a relay from the server side, that then sends that back into JavaScript, which we use to track mobile web. In those cases, we're dealing with the smartphone-only world. So it ends up being a little more work for the developer to do that. So you'll find whatever analytics service you're working with, they'll provide the data standard for, you know, you take the whatever parameter that has the UDID number in, and you want to carry that over to the web. So it's cookies and device ID. That's the biggest challenge. Now, we see a whole different grade of that. So we've got to work with a number of different platform providers, application platform providers that will publish, you know, full HTML, JavaScript, CSS into a native application wrapper. That's a little trickier, actually. So we're continuing to invest in that space, and I think as the mobile web browsers have more and more access to device information, which is the trend that we're seeing, it'll really simplify that a lot.
All right, so I just want to thank Isabel, Moody, and Eric for a fantastic